take a ride? From the high desert and the great American Southwest, exclusively on Sirius XM Radio, this is Dark Matter with your host, Art Bell.
Extra.
Now, here's Art.
Terrestrial radio. I'm in a hurry, I guess. Sorry, Ross. Welcome, everybody. Welcome, Dark Riders. I love that. I love that term, Dark Riders. I'm sure it'll get stolen. Everything else around here is getting stolen from me. But it's all right, because remember, it originated here with me. All right, I've got a whole bunch of stuff I want to say before we get to our guest, Jason Martell, who's going to be talking about what came before us. That's right, what came before us. I want to say hi to my two little roses over there at the house. Hi, Asia. Our little six-year-old first grader is under the weather. She's got a temperature varying between 100 point and 102. And so, not feeling well. And so, every night she wishes me extra, 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 extra good luck as I leave. So, extra, 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 get better, honey. And, of course, Aaron, who is taking care of her over there, and me, who's hiding from the virus here. Been lucky. Really, I have been lucky lately. I didn't get the last cold. Now we're going to see if I get this one. Doing international living is interesting. I, you know, of course, was over in the Philippines, where we had the benefit of Asia going to preschool there, and every available Southeast Asian virus, we've had them. Then preschool here, and all the North American viruses. They've been interesting. And now first grade and the first grade viruses. It's lucky I'm here at all tonight, actually. We had, oh, before I get into that, I've done some audio adjustments. So I would like your objective opinion, please. As you listen on XM, as you listen on Sirius, and as you listen on the web, whether the audio sounds okay to you. I found it very, very disconcerting that some people were telling me that Skype sounded better than I did. Very disconcerting. I mean, Skype is good, but, you know, it's not supposed to be studio mic good. Anyway, lucky I'm here. We had forecasts originally for, get this, folks, 75 mile an hour winds. Then they cut it down to 70, down to 65, and then 55. And today we had 50 mile an hour winds. It was ripping out there. So I was thinking, well, will we have internet? Will we have power? Will I have a house? But it's turned out okay, so we're here. And the wind has indeed this evening let up, thank goodness. The desert can rage, believe me. All right, so the wind didn't get me. And what almost did, though, Saturday, was I was standing in the living room, and I felt something on the back of my neck moving, and I reached back and slapped it hard, and I came away with a handful of goo, and this thing that fell on the floor that looked like, to me, the Godzilla of spiders. It wasn't. It was probably a baby tarantula is my best guess because it was hairy. Anyway, I slapped it, killed it, but not before it nailed me in three places. One main one and two little ones. It nailed me, but good. And, you know, I thought, this is it. When you get it in the back of the neck like this. Now, the spider either crawled on me at some point and got to my neck, or fell on me, I thought, from the ceiling. Either way, doesn't matter. I thought I was toast. And I did a little drama and staggered around the house for a while. I really actually did think I was toast. I thought, well, if it's poison, it's here in my neck, it's right next to the brain, and it's going to be fast. So I didn't go to the hospital. The hospital came to me. The fire department came with medics. They checked me out, wrote a long report, and they need all these numbers. You know, social security numbers and on and on and on. Anyway, bottom line is I'm okay. The spider, they had me save the spider in a little jar with some bread to keep it in good shape so that if I did suddenly fall over, I'd be able to take my aggressor with me to the hospital and they could look at him and tell me what he is. Pretty good. There's a picture on the website, by the way, of the spider, or actually only what's left of the spider. The majority of him was goo. So if it's big ick factor, right? Goo all over my hand, goo over the back of my neck, the side of the back of my neck. And there's a picture up there of my neck, too, where he bit me. So I continue to be here by the grace of... Sorry, Matthew, God, by the grace of God. Now, our ghost picture contest, it's over, but it's not over judging-wise. I want you all to go to artbell.com, and we've got some tragically bad ghost pictures, and we've got some real winners. I mean some really, really good ghost photographs. So you be the judge. The winner, you know, gets a radio and a one-year subscription to Sirius XM, so... Go up there and judge. You are the ones that are going to pick the winner. It's that simple. Really, you're going to pick the winner. Not me. Not the Ghostmaster. You. So you need to go up there and give kudos and points to the good ghost photographs. Okay? You can kind of leaf through them. And ghost stories, by the way. And we'll announce the winner of the ghost photograph contest on Spooky Matter on Thursday. It's coming right up. If you have a ghost story, there is still time to get it in. Send me a simple summary of your ghost story and include a phone number at the bottom, and perhaps we will call you. That's right. We may call you. All right. Things to see on the website tonight. Oh, heavens, I have a video for you that I'm telling you. It was covered by a local Pueblo, Colorado TV station. This, ladies and gentlemen, is a... I don't want to give it all away. Here's all I'll say. It's about a woman who got caught in a flood. You know, they had a lot of floods there. And she's in her car as it sinks. But there is an ending to this story that will blow you away. I'm serious. It's that good. So you need to go up to the website and then leaf through, you know, at the front there, you'll see the picture of the oil rig. And then you've got little arrows and you can sort of, or just wait and it'll click through. When you get to the one of Pueblo, Colorado, oh my. You need to see that and see it to the very end. All right, don't stop halfway through or stop once you see her rescued, because the punchline, which will send chills down your spine, I mean, this probably gets near the level of a miracle. All right, it's all at artbell.com. Also, I sent Keith, though I don't know that he's put it up yet, the Dome of the Rock UFO. You remember that? Somebody sent four synced cameras in of that UFO. And of course, as I mentioned, the oil platform. Other reasons to go to artbell.com? Well, the wormhole for one, where you can send me a message. Just find the wormhole and send me a message. It will go in Arizona and back out again here in Nevada, right in front of me. An Oklahoma school teacher says she's seen heaven's pearly gates and lived to tell the tale. Crystal McVeigh's near-death experience brought her face to face with a God that she spent a lifetime doubting. And the Altus, Oklahoma woman says the only reason that she's even alive is so she can tell others now. About 10 to 20% of people who go into cardiac arrest or clinical death have lucid memories of their brush with death. She remembers. She claims she talked to God. She was treated for pancreatitis in 2009 when an unexpected reaction to pain medication caused her to stop breathing. That's it. On the way to room temperature, as Rush would say. But she had this amazing experience. And this is a really, really big topic that I want to talk to you about. I want to have a serious discussion about it. No pun intended. So we're going to be looking for people who have had, well, death and an experience that they would be willing to relate, and then life again. It is an intensely interesting subject for me. As you know, as I hear the footsteps, I'm 68 years old now, so I can hear footsteps in the distance. Very interesting topic. So if you've had something like that, email me, artbell@artbell.com. Looking very briefly at the news, we were all hoping that immigration reform would happen this year. Doesn't look so good now. They're just not going to agree on anything. And if anything's broken, I'll tell you, the immigration system is, I know, personal experience, is really broken. In fact, here's how broken it is. If you send paperwork to the Immigration and Naturalization Service, and if that paperwork is lost, even if you have a receipt showing that they received it, stamped it, it doesn't matter. It's your fault. Not their fault. It's your fault. Even if you can prove they received it, signed for it, it's your fault. And that's only an example of what it's like. It needs overhaul. So let's hope they get to it. With website woes ongoing, the administration Monday granted a 6-week extension that'll be until March 31st for Americans to sign up for their shiny new healthcare coverage and pay whatever they're going to have to pay. Maybe the administration thought people out here were still using dial-up or something. I don't know. The governors of Pacific coastal U.S. states, that'd be California, Oregon, Washington, I guess, and a Canadian province to boot, are all going to begin coordinating policies that place a price on greenhouse pollution, greenhouse gas pollution, and mandating the use of cleaner burning fuels or else. So all of that's going on. Don't forget, come Thursday, Spooky Matter begins. No guests. I never, ever have guests on that show. Spooky Matter will be ghost stories only. And while I thought there's no way the people at that other program could step lower than the things that have already happened, now I've heard they're poaching our ghosts. That's right. A good dozen of our ghosts have reported that they've been poached. They'll be on the other program. Just kidding. I know you People are asking me what kind of spider it was. I don't know. Could be a baby tarantula or whatever. There's a picture of it up on the website if you want to see it. So they're messaging me. What kind? I don't know. It was the kind that didn't kill me. I was certainly pleased about that. Jason Martell is coming up in a moment. Oh, Arts Parts. I got word they're selling like crazy. There is something about dark matter that people really like. I'm not sure what it is. It just goes with so many things. For example, if you have a coffee cup, I mean, if it says dark matter on it, right? And the t-shirts and the hats and all that, there's something about the phrase dark matter that people really like. Maybe that's why it's being copied all over the place. Anyway, Jason Martell coming up. If you're listening to Dark Matter on a computer, sitting on a desk somewhere, I have such a good idea for you. You need the CC FM transmitter 2. Why? It is so cool. You simply plug your computer into the CC radio of the CC radio. The you can do that, by the way, with a radio into the FM transmitter 2, and it will cheerfully then transmit my show to any FM radio in the house. Now, how cool is that? You set your own frequency, you know, anywhere in the FM band where you find no other station, because you're going to have your own station. So it's pretty cool stuff. It'll really work for you, and a lot of people who listen to me are doing it. It comes with an AC adapter, so you can plug it in, or you can put a couple of AA batteries in there. It covers a whole FM band, as I mentioned. It's portable. It'll small enough to fit in the palm of your hand. What a cool device this is. It has adjustable input levels for very near broadcast quality audio. Something I'm looking for too. The FM transmitter 2 is rated. Rated? It's rated A, but they rated a price. $49.95. Why would you say it's rated for only $49.95? Typo. $49.95 is quite a buy, folks. Call the Sea Crane Company right now. That really is a good price. At 800-522-8863. That's 1-800-522-8863. Well, okay, here we go. I love long-form talk radio, especially one with only a couple of breaks, you know, every hour, mostly content. For over 15 years, Mr. Jason Martell has been one of the leading researchers and lecturers specializing in ancient advanced technologies. Mr. Martell's research has been featured worldwide on numerous TV networks, Discovery Channel, History Channel, Sci-Fi Channel, BBC, and others. Today, Mr. Martell is working on his next scientific recreation of ancient technology based on data obtained from the Sumerian cuneiform cylinder seals from 3000 BC. He is also planning several groundbreaking international research expeditions. The expeditions focus on gaining access to ancient Sumerian artifacts and other archaeological relics not currently accessible to the public. In other words, secret stuff. In addition to his research, Mr. Martell is founder of www.booyahmedia.com. How's that for a name? B-O-O-Y-A. Booyahmedia.com, a leading mobile technology company. Here is Mr. Jason Martell. Jason, welcome to Dark Matter.
Hey, Art. Thank you so much for having me on your show.
You're most welcome. I really am looking forward to this. I want to qualify the beginning of the show here, Jason, by saying I'm kind of a skeptic when it comes to this sort of thing.
Excellent.
However, I am ready for you to try and convince me, because I would love to believe it is so.
Well, I know you're a seasoned pro in these topics, so it's kind of an honor for me to just have these conversations directly with you and see how you respond.
Okay, good. So what we're talking about here is man or something before man. In other words, something so old that it rose up as a civilization of sorts and became extinct before we ever arrived on the planet, you know, human beings. Is that
yeah,
fair?
That's pretty much right on the head, Art. You know, diving into that a little deeper, basically, you know, when I first started to look into these topics, I was 21, I'm now 39, and I started to be very interested in realizing that most of the ancient cultures that we're aware of, the infamous ones, the Egyptians and Mayans and India and such, they're all referencing a lost culture. Now, we only talk about it as Atlantis or Lumeria, but science has actually been turning the tables in the last 15 years in that topics like Atlantis or these lost civilizations are really starting to come back into the scientific focus to find cultures that existed beyond what we know of today as Sumer, ancient Egypt, which we put that date at around 3800 BC is when the civilizations that we know of today kind of sprung up out of the Stone Age.
All right. Is there truly enough time in the evolution of the Earth itself, I'm talking about the Earth itself, for life to have actually started, evolved here on Earth, or was it life, do you think, sent here perhaps already whole and complete?
Well, let me give you a little bit of background on how I got interested in these topics, just for your audience and for you as well, and kind of answer that question. You know, when I was in college, as I mentioned, someone had just kind of mentioned to me. Now, I had no interest in aliens or ancient history or anything. I was a waiter and I was a surfer and just a normal college student. But then someone just kind of mentioned to me that there was possibly pyramids and a face on Mars and that NASA had taken these photos. And I was very skeptical and was like, you know, I mean, why would NASA hide something like that? It turns out, Art, that I was going to school in San Diego and Malin Space Science Systems was two blocks away from me. So as I started to listen to your show and Richard Hoagland and other people, as a young layman college student, I became very interested in, are there actually artificial structures on Mars? So I contacted Dr. Mike Malin directly. Dr. Mike Malin is the principal scientist in charge for the last 30 years of the cameras that we place on all our orbiters.
That's right. I have spoken to him a number of times.
Yes, yes. And so as a college student, you know, I reached out to Dr. Malin and said, listen, is there any possibility that these structures on Mars are artificial? And he said, well, no, these are all natural, you know, sand and wind-eroded objects, nothing intelligent to see here. That kind of made my eyebrows raise a little higher, right? So what I started to do is just really take my focus off of Mars, because this is on another planet, when I realized there's structures here all over the Earth that we can't explain, and that's kind of led me on the path of what we're going to talk about tonight.
All right. May I stop you enough to ask if you have reviewed the work of Richard C. Hoagland?
Of course I have.
Good.
Bought the Monuments of Mars, I think two editions, had him sign one, went to his birthday party in Del Mar many years back. I think the first time I met him was at a book signing of yours, which was in Encinitas, California. Again, well over 10 years ago.
I remember.
All right.
Well, you know, I have been a skeptic with Richard as well, although the last time he was on the program here on Dark Matter, he did hit me, Jason, with something that I found. He called it number 9. I don't suppose you've seen number 9, have you?
No.
It's a artifact on Mars, Jason, and the damn thing has a pipe sticking out of it. I mean, you might call it a rock, even though there's other aspects of it that are just startling, but it has a perfectly round pipe sticking out of it. And there's no way, Jason, that this is a natural object. Simple as that. You know, that one got me. So if you have an opportunity to view what's called number 9, it's probably still up on my website, take a look at that and let me know what you think.
I'll definitely check it out. That's
okay.
He's always been infamous for finding artifacts and you know, things that I guess we're really never going to know until we send a manned mission. But I definitely was very intrigued initially by the Cydonia complex, the geometry and the math being displayed there, which really made me focus on a lot of these ancient cultures and raise the question for me, where do we really come from?
Well, NASA always kind of poo-pooed the face on Mars, right?
Yes, they did. And I even refer to in my lectures sometimes when I show a chronological time range from 76 until, I think, 2009 of various images. And one of them I, to this day, still call the cat box image.
Yeah. But here's the thing I was going to point out, Jason. Even though they poo-pooed it, I noticed they spent a disproportionate amount of time going back to Cydonia. So while they publicly poo-pooed it, they kept going back. Now, that's got to mean something.
Right. Well, I think you and I and many of your listeners are on the belief that there is a public space program, and that's publicly reported. You know, there's also a non-public space program, which is a little more hard to track and put our hands around. But I've leaned less on the cover-up at NASA, simply because I realize that there's a political backup in that some engineer has been working at NASA for 19 years making some little arm that's going to be on the rover, and this little arm's going to stick into the dirt and look for some amino acids. Mm-hmm. But there's no, like, rabbit catcher or Martian catcher or something that's going to actually identify life. We don't have any instruments actually deployed on any of our rovers that are going to, you know, scientifically confirm life. We're only looking for signs of life. So we're not quite there yet. But if anyone does pay attention, it has been very educating for me, just as a civilian, to see that, you know, what they release from the surface of Mars, there is what appear to be vegetation and questionable objects, as we were talking about. So it does, I think, raise a little bit of curiosity.
All right. Let me pose this to you. There are things there that really do raise your eyebrows. Now, is it possible that NASA is well aware that there are artifacts on Mars from somebody or something that was there earlier, and they're releasing these photographs, and when somebody finally goes, oh my God, that's absolutely not some natural formation, that's artificial, and when they finally do that, NASA can say, yep, that's kind of what we've been suspecting too, and we've been right up front with you because we've released all the photographs. Up to you.
Right. Well, you know, this kind of leads to what we're going to talk about with some of the geometry and megalithic mm-hmm. monuments here on Earth. I think the answer to that, Art, is if we ever do send people back to the moon publicly, or to Mars, what we need to do are look at some of these monuments and some of the alignments astronomically that take place. Because here on Earth, there are monuments built all over the world, on every continent, that are specifically aligned to star constellations.
That's
and
right.
These alignments repeat. So it's very possible that some of these other structures and geometrical diagrams are probably on the moon and Mars as well, and will collaborate further with what we have here on Earth.
Okay. All right, let's come back to Earth then. The theory of panspermia, what is that?
Right. So, you know, there's a scientific term called panspermia, which basically says that in order for evolution here on Earth to actually have taken place in the 4.7 billion years that, you know, it's been in Earth, There's just not enough time frame. The analogy is, you know, if a tornado went through a junkyard and assembled a 747, that's the likelihood that all the elements would be, you know, swung together in this primordial soup hit by lightning. So panspermia is just a theory, and there's even a modified one that says direct panspermia, which means life arrives whole and complete here. Direct panspermia would simply be that someone sent life here, whole and complete, which I kind of like. But that is a scientific term, and it does at least step into the doorway of explaining evolution here on Earth at a life system level. But when we get to the human being topic, I think there's a much more interesting discussion around what isn't a Darwinian evolution from something ever simplistic coming more complex. We seem to be here on Earth in a repeating cycle, which I'm going to call the Great Year. And many ancient cultures seem to be aware of a cyclical nature of something that repeats here on Earth on a very large scale of time. And that's why I think a lot of these monuments and things that we have are basically part of a much larger calendar system that the ancients were using.
All right. Well, the way you pronounce it suggests to me, I didn't realize it was panspermia. So that would suggest the genesis, I suppose, right?
Yes.
Yes, uh-huh, okay. So what is your theory? Was life, in what way was life seeded on Earth? What's your best guess?
Well, my best guess, you know, really is that we seem to be in some type of a large cycle that is creating life here on Earth to evolve to a certain state and then drop out of this evolutionary state and kind of forget everything. So, you know, when we speak of life in general, that's kind of a broader topic that I'll bypass for tonight and go right to the human evolution, if you don't mind.
That's fine.
And, you know, this is a really interesting topic, Art, because this is what led me to my research, is I wanted to figure out, where do we come from? Who is the oldest culture that has led up to us? And that led me into the Sumerian culture and Planet X and the Anunnaki, which is a good topic for us to touch on. But, you know, from a higher level still, I started to realize that there seems to be a larger cycle of time that all the ancients were aware of. And we know of it, we just don't understand it. We hear things called the Golden Age or the Dark Ages, mm-hmm. or why there's the division of the heavens into 12 parts, into these zodiacal symbols. Well, it seems that the ancients were aware of some knowledge and used a system of time based on astronomical movements, which is just now starting to come into our comprehension in modern times.
All right. You're suggesting, I believe, that Darwinian evolution is flawed, because you say they will never find the missing link. How do you know that?
Right. Well, Darwinian evolution is, I think, this view that everything simple is going to become ever more complex. So if we go further and further back into our history, we mm-hmm. should pretty much just find more simple cultures and tribes. And then into the future, we're just going to become super advanced. What I'm seeing is actually that's not the case. It seems that there is a cycle here on Earth that is repeating, and it's a large cycle that lasts around 24,000 years. Now, you know, a lot of the ancient cultures made reference to the fact that there is this cycle. The Mayans got a lot of publicity recently because they talked about a calendar system that was so accurate, and their calendar came to an ending point in 2012. Well, it wasn't actually an ending point. It was just an ending point in one of their calendars. So it's just very interesting, Art, that we can talk about some of the specifics tonight, in that many different ancient cultures were aware of this large cycle of time and built monuments that align to specific star constellations that are kind of like markers in space as to where we are in this large cycle of time.
Okay, I still missed it somehow. You're saying that we will never find the missing link.
I kind of breezed over that one, sorry.
I really want the answer to that. Why will we never find the missing link?
I don't think that we'll not ever find the missing link. I just don't think that right now we're ready to accept what it is. And in my opinion, it has to be some type of genetic intervention. Whether that be from an alien civilization or some lost culture that we're not on the record of understanding now. But it appears that if we look at the anthropological bone record of mm-hmm. Australopithecine and Neanderthal, and, you know, comparing this bone to that bone, when we get to us and compare us to the closest relation of a Neanderthal, there's a huge gap between them and us. So somehow, magically, there was some type of a genetic intervention that took the hominoid that was maybe evolving here naturally and kind of made him into us. And I say that just from a very high level of, you know, if you look at a basic human and you put them naked in the jungle and had them run around, their skin would get, you know, cut by branches, they'd get sunburned. And if you look at an ape and how strong they are compared to us and all the body hair that protects them, we are just extremely different at many levels when we look at this Darwinian evolution of bones and such.
All right, that's fascinating. I do have a question, though. Is it possible, Jason, that if there was a, and by the way, I believe it could be true, there was some genetic modification achieved by a power that we don't understand. Mm-hmm. If that occurred, and I'm not a scientist, is it possible that a geneticist could uncover evidence that that occurred?
I think so. And as we, you know, further decode the human genome, I know that there's already lots of what they call junk DNA and things that
are
in our DNA that they're just kind of scratching their head going, well, you know, I guess it does something, but we don't really know.
Right.
Good friend of mine, Lloyd Pye, who I'm sure you're also familiar with.
I know Lloyd well.
Yeah, and I hope he's doing better. He's, you know, had some bouts with health recently, but he's a trooper. And he really did a lot of work around the genetics and wrote a book called Everything You Know Is Wrong, where he kind of gets deep into the genetic side of looking at the various elements of our gene code and breaking down where these anomalies exist and why they should be called out.
I'm not sure that finding it would be a problem if a geneticist did find it. One could still say, look, that's where God's hand touched the human, or created the human, if you will. Or one could suggest that a race far, far ahead of ours stepped in and did the deed.
Yes. Well, I guess only time will tell as we, you know, our sciences advance more so that we can use, you know, various quantum computing here in the future, I guess, and do things where we can get a much more whole and complete view of our genetic code. And if we ever do get to interact with other, you know, publicly, if we ever get to interact with other life forms of intelligence, then there might be very interesting DNA samples from them that we can compare. But right now, right, it's all kind of a door shut. There aren't any aliens. No one's willing to cross that line scientifically. So that's why, Art, you know, I've spent my time, you know, the last decade or so, really looking at the ancient evidence. All the modern things with aliens and you know, even our genetics and science and stuff, it's very interesting, but what we do have is just a wealth of information from all these ancient cultures, and the things that they went to great lengths to communicate to us, which we now think of mainly as mythology, really deserve another eye in looking at that evidence and saying, well, all these things that have happened in the past that we think are mythology, as our sciences kind of start to merge more with what's possible in the science fiction realm, I think we can see that some of the stuff in the past starts to raise people's eyebrows a little bit more and pay attention when we look at, you know, various structures and understand that the architecture and building skills that went into some of these monuments is very intriguing.
Okay. All right. Did you see the series After Man, I think it was called, where they showed 100 years after man was gone from the planet, 1,000, million,
I don't think
10
so.
Million. Too bad, because it showed what would happen to, for example, American architecture. Our buildings, everything that is man, would virtually disappear given enough years. And that sort of fits into what we're going to be talking about.
Yeah, and that makes sense. And, you know, we get left with just a random piece of an artifact or tablets or texts, you know, or tales. And so, Art, for me, some of these ancient cultures, it's really interesting to see how they've played out scenarios in even more recent times that people can relate to that allows us to look further back in the past. And let me give you an example. I know you've heard of the term cargo cult. So
I have.
Yeah. And so for your audience, you know, in like World War I, World War II, when we first started flying U.S. troops over Australia and Africa, and we landed in certain rural areas where, you know, a tribesman had never seen a white man or they'd never seen a biplane in technology, you know, a soldier gets out, lights up a cigarette, and holds out a voice recorder and records the Aboriginal's voice and plays it back to him. The Aboriginals are freaking out. They're like, wow, this is like a god, you know, and the ship that he came in, what is this? So even as recently as World War I and World War II, we see it playing out that when the soldiers left, and I should also mention, every now and then, the soldier camps would get drop shipments, like a plane, a cargo plane flies over and just drops a bag of goods. Sometimes that bag of goods would land in the middle of a tribe instead of the camp, and they'd crack it open and find all these things falling from the sky, and they'd be like, oh, you know. So when the soldiers left,
Coke bottle, for example.
Right, exactly. Yeah, like that funny movie.
let me tell you just a very brief story. I went up into communist China with Bob Crane and his wife, and this was years and years ago, just after it kind of opened. And we went into some small villages, and Bob Crane's wife is a blonde. And I'm telling you, Jason, people came out of their homes in these little towns and just stood and stared in almost disbelief. You know, they hadn't seen Westerners, and a Westerner with blonde hair, that's big time. So It's kind of like that in a way. I mean, they were so isolated that they were just amazed to see it. See Westerners, see blonde hair. Yeah.
Go ahead. Just wanted to squeeze out that analogy before I get it. What was simply that the cargo cult is that, you know, when the soldiers left, the Aboriginals started to scrape out runways, made mm-hmm. straw models of aircraft, and started to kind of worship these as items, hoping to entice the soldiers to come back.
And so, are you referring now to the runways down in Peru, that kind of thing?
Well, not really. I mean, that's a different set of circumstances, but just okay. in general, the idea of a cargo cult, even in recent times, we see how greatly it affects these Aboriginals. So when we look back into the past, places like Bolivia and Peru and South America, we see these very clear attempts to communicate to whatever must have been in the sky at that time. And the paradox there is that none of the civilizations that were human at that time had hot air balloons or gliders or any type of flight, yet they were clearly communicating to people in the sky.
Okay. Clearly. I mean, you sound pretty sure about that.
Well, you know, when we look in, for instance, Peru, you know, where the Nazca lines are, since we bring that up, we have that mm-hmm. wonderful figure of El Astronauto carved mm-hmm. into a mountainside, and he's kind of, you know, they're waving high to anybody that would see him. And any of those structures in Peru, like the runways or what really intrigued me are actually in the foothills, some of the mountains right in that range in Bolivia, we find very large geometric patterns. And you can't see any of these. You can't see El Astronauto or any of the Nazca figurines, as most people know, unless you're in the sky in some type of conveyance that allows you to be above the surface of the ground.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So, you know, I thought it was really interesting that, you know, there are various descriptions in even more recent times of how ancient people handle this, but it starts to get really interesting, and this kind of ties into what you just said with your Bob Crane's wife. What's also very interesting in studying a lot of these South American cultures, these are all mostly dark-haired people, dark-skinned, mm-hmm. but their gods are usually tall, pale, blonde people. Kukulkan and Quetzalcoatl and various other South American gods are either depicted with long red hair or white hair, and they usually are pale in skin. Now, this is a very interesting paradox when all the...
It is. It is, because we generally, we as humans, model our gods after, I think you're going to suggest, what they thought were gods.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
How long ago are we talking about right now? If we went back to the time when these gods were being created, or the image of these gods, how long ago was that?
We're roughly talking around 2500 BC, or pretty much 4,000 years ago.
Okay.
And what we see across the board, Art, is, you know, various cultures from Egyptian to Mesopotamian, Mayan, they all have what appears to be, you know, very articulate and well-positioned monuments that create these alignments. And some of these monuments are actually dedicated towards reuniting or some ceremony around their god. In Chichen Itza in South America, on a specific day, when the sun hits the side of the pyramid, it makes this light and shadow effect of a serpent coming down the steps. And, you know, to build a pyramid at a specific angle so that an astronomical shadow will create an effect that repeats every year, that's pretty good.
And it is indeed pretty good. Hold tight a moment, Jason. It is indeed pretty good. And then I wonder how all of this mixes into what happened 2,000 years ago, plus a little now. I don't know, and then the whole Adam and Eve thing and... But this is fascinating stuff. From the high desert and the great American Southwest, this is Dark Matter, Raging in the Night.
5836.
Jason Martell is my guest, and a very, very interesting guest he is. We're talking about what may have come before us, way before us. There are signs, there may be links, there may be artifacts, there may be a lot of things that will connect to the fact that we are not the first. Jason, welcome back.
Thank you, Art.
All right. How frequently, with the kind of thing that you're talking about, do you run smack into the Bible?
Well, I was raised as a Christian. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that really was one of the first things that I think at a very young age, I, you know, would be in church and I'd look up someone next to me and they're raising their hands and really feeling it. And I didn't understand why I couldn't get in touch with a higher power. So for me, I started from that angle, but really I have such a great respect for all the world religions because, you know, I now see kind of a unification in all the ancient views kind of being very similar, that something happened in our past very clearly where there was a time when there were giants upon the earth, whether that means great in stature or actually physical giants, but there seems to have been a time when most ancient cultures interacted with their living gods, where we've lost that connection.
Well, you know, we're talking about that missing link in that moment when whatever was here was touched magically in some way. Or technologically in some way, and so began the human. Well, you know, if that touch were to be said to be God's, I don't think there'd be a problem. If that touch were said to be alien, I think there'd be a big problem. Have you thought that over?
I have, and it might be a good time for us to talk about the oldest civilization that we have record on Earth, the Sumerian civilization, because that's really where one of the jumping points for me, as far as curiosity, again, coming from a Christian background, in studying the Sumerian culture, which is today's southern Iraq, it's been called Mesopotamia, Babylon, originally Sumer. And what we have out of Sumer are a collection of cuneiform scripts, which is a written language, as well as pictograms in the form of cylinder seals and various tablets. And for me, Art, it became very clear when the archaeological evidence started to support stories in the Bible, but as fact. So some of the things like the flood tablet, we have in the British Museum on display, there's a tablet called the flood tablet, and it's written in an ancient Akkadian text. They've actually found a few other various versions, but essentially, what we have here is a story of the Great Flood recorded in stone, predating the Hebrew or the King James version of this tale, and it's thousands of years before these known texts that we have today.
I guess it would be too much or difficult for you to actually lay out what is in that tablet and the way they described it, because I'd be very curious. Are you able to do that?
I can, to a certain degree. Essentially, what we have is, you know, in the Bible, we have a very truncated version of a story that lasts 7 days and God creating the heavens and the earth.
Right.
But in the Sumerian version, there are actually seven tablets of creation. And these tablets very specifically explain how we come into being. And it's a process, basically, that is explained.
Wait, I'm sorry. I thought it was the flood. We were going to talk about the flood tablet.
I'm sorry. Yeah, got carried away there.
Okay.
Just jumped right in another topic.
Right.
Now, the flood tablet on display in the British Museum is, again, one of those that is part of a much larger set of texts. It's called, actually, the Enuma Elish. There was about 11 tablets. So this one specific tablet in that story explains the flood. And what's interesting about the Sumerian version is it very specifically says why there was a great flood. It cites that there is a much larger a body. And now, let me put a little preface on this, too. There's only been a handful of scholars that actually read Sumerian cuneiform script, this ancient language. And most of the translations that I'm going to reference in our discussion tonight are translated through Zachariah Sitchin. Now, mainstream science will look at Zachariah Sitchin's descriptions and will argue over a certain word or a phrase and the meaning of that word or that specific phrase. However, no one in the archaeological community is able to compile a well-rounded, woven story interlinking all of the information from these tablets.
Gotcha. All right, Jason, right? What I'm searching for here is, does it describe things like when the flood came, how much of the earth the flood covered, how long it lasted? In other words, does it lay it out?
No, it doesn't. And if it does, I unfortunately am not that close to it to be able to answer it that way. But what I can do is, again, just validate the fact that this tale isn't just a biblical tale. We have an actual artifact predating the paper version of our Bible, essentially telling the same thing. Why that's important, Art, is there are other tablets, there are other pieces of information, touch on other highly significant biblical events, like Adam and Eve or the creation of our actual earth. And so putting all of that into a pot and stirring it together, we have very interesting information that come out of some of the most ancient cultures that we have, where we are now almost starting to scientifically confirm a lot of these biblical pieces that we thought were just allegory myth.
For example, Adam and Eve? You're saying it confirms Adam and Eve?
Well, you know, confirm is, it's a hypothesis, and there's evidence there to support it.
I'm using your word.
Yeah. When we look at the evidence and things that we've pulled out of the Sumerian descriptions of their tales, we have very clear descriptions of them creating us in their image and after their likeness, just like the Bible says. But in some of these Sumerian texts, it's a lot more elongated. There is a text specifically talking about how the Adam was created. And it wasn't Adam as in, that's your name.
Adamu.
The Adam, correct. The word Adamu is a plural in Hebrew for worker. So the Sumerian texts actually explain that one of these gods that came here, they called them Anunnaki, and that's a term used throughout the Sumerian texts to refer to their gods, Anunnaki. That just simply means those who from heaven come to earth. One of their texts explains how a very specific Anunnaki, she was a chief medical officer. Her name was Ninhursag, and she actually created the first working Adam. There were two or three versions that didn't function, where the arm in one didn't work, another the kidney didn't function, and they actually have cylinder-sealed descriptions, little pictograms, little scenes that go along with these texts. And you see her holding up a small being, and she's saying, I've done it. In the background, what appear to be tubes and vases on a shelf. Could this be a primitive representation of an in vitro fertilization? I don't know.
Was there a pictorial of her?
Yes. There's a
What did she look like?
Well, we look like them. They look like us. I mean, essentially...
Okay, these were done... obviously, I'm not looking at them. I mean, basically in stick form, or it had to be a little better than that because you're describing it as a her.
Right. So what they did was the person who could create these drawings was called a scribe, and he used something called a stylus, which looks like an oversized screwdriver. And right. They would twist it and turn it to make the text in wet clay. And accompanying that, we still don't know how they did this, but they would take a piece of wet clay and carve in reverse these intricate little figurines and pictures. So they're not just stick figures. There are, you know, detailed figures and art, but they would carve it in reverse. Sorry, Art. They would carve it in reverse, and then when you pressed it into another piece of wet clay, it would leave the positive imprint. So it was very fascinating that they were able to even do that at such a scale.
All right, how were you able to, or how was anybody able to discern it was a female?
Well, the texts explain that she's a female, and okay. when you look at her in the picture, she's actually got a ponytail, and her face features are more feminine.
Okay. All right. And she created the atom, which was turned out to be a small... Are we talking about a baby?
Right. So it's the first working model, and I'm sure it was, you know, a child. And, you know, it's... Again, when we look at this as just a mythological tale, it's pretty darn accurate considering okay. how we look at, you know, again, test tube fertilization or in vitro fertilization.
Oh, I'm with you. If it happened now, how did the Eve get created?
Well, you know, that part gets a little bit more convoluted into the genetic side, which I'd probably not do any good to speak at it from my angle. Other than the understanding,
I mean, there was this whole rib thing, you know.
Right, right. Well, that's what I was going to say. Is other than the understanding of the biblical term, but you know, I think just from a core concept, we have many of these stories that come out of ancient Sumer, where it's, you know, it's a really interesting piece of the puzzle, and some of it, again, when we try and piece it together with science, their creation myth. Goes into a very detailed explanation as to how our Earth was even created and pretty much fits with our current cosmology. If we understand that the Earth now is kind of, the continents are all moved into a certain position, but at some point they were one large landmass called Pangaea.
Right.
And, you know,
and that does make sense because if you try it, the Earth, you know, the continents, they fit together.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And the Sumerians give a very interesting tale of explaining that our primitive Earth, billions of years ago, they say before it had finished becoming a solid mass, it had this interaction with what they called Nibiru. It was a kind of like a rogue star that somehow got attracted to our solar system, and there was this collision between our primitive Earth and one of the moons of this star, or this planet that came into our solar system, and this huge...
All right, what you're referring to is Planet X, right?
I am.
Okay, and you're saying that it was not Planet X that collided with or even disturbed us by being close, but it was one of the moons of Planet X that collided with Earth.
That's correct, yes. Yes, and so...
Okay.
The Sumerians don't use the term Planet X. They use the term Nibiru. And right. we again see similarities in this cosmological story from the Sumerians where when this collision took place, we had half of our Earth get strewn out into what we now call the asteroid belt. Mm-hmm. The Bible calls it the hammered out bracelet. And then the Earth that we know of goes into its current position in its new orbit. Now, after a large calamity like that, where half the planet is strewed out into the asteroid belt, if you think about it, that leaves us with just half a planet, literally a Pangaea. But mm-hmm. over time, we've now moved into the positions like the skin of an apple. The continents have moved to where they are. So there's little pieces like that, Art, where the Sumerian version of many of the stories of our creation or of our cosmology, our science is kind of catching up and going, huh, the Sumerians actually knew information that our sciences are just now starting to confirm.
So what you're suggesting, there's two ways to look at this. One is the biblical, and the other is something even older that you've been talking about, and you're suggesting that they do coincide, but at some point, you're going to have to sort of make a intellectual mental choice about, well, the Bible, this was one way to explain it, but over here we have this other thing that happened, and it's the real thing that happened.
Right, and so that's why there's this wonderful context from all the other cultures around the world, not just our one Judeo-Christian view or the, you know, Mesopotamian view that's now extracted into our Christian view. There are all these other collaborating cultures that have a similar line of evidence in that the knowledge that they had, it seems to be so complex that when we look at most of these ancient cultures like the Egyptians, Mayans, and Sumer, they were right out of the Stone Age, right at the time when it seems to have been that they were, you know, just starting, they're at the most advanced part of their civilization. And then they kind of gradually went downhill. So it's a hard thing for us to try and figure out, like, why are these gaps in knowledge? It seems like many of the ancient cultures knew a bunch of information and ways to build monuments that we can't today. And then we kind of forgot it all when we went into the Dark Ages.
Jason, you do realize that not all that long ago, they would have strapped you to a couple of hunks of wood with kindling underneath, and they would have burned you alive as warlock.
Mm-hmm. You're right, and that's part of us coming out of the Dark Ages, where we've been in this, you know, we went into this realm where we kind of lose all of this information. But as we go further back, Art, we look at these monuments in various sites, and we see alignments and things that point to a much earlier date than Sumer or Egypt, and we don't know where they come from. And I can give you some examples, and this one, of course.
Ballpark, when you say much older, give me an idea of how much older.
10,500 BC and older, maybe between 10,500 BC to, let's say, 50,000 BC. So much further into our past. We've just now started to uncover sites, thankfully due to the work of a show on the History Channel that's now in its sixth season. I'm grateful to be a part of it, Ancient Aliens. They have been finding and researching sites that really were not even on the radar. Sites like Göbekli Tepe in Turkey.
Mm-hmm. What is the best evidence that you would cite from these programs, from that research, of something that old?
I get that question a lot. I love it. And, I think for me, the answer is vitrification. Some people might have to Google that. It is a good term. But vitrification means the heating of a stone until it becomes a molten state. And so what we see, Art, is, you know, at Machu Picchu and Teotihuacan and Pumapunku and all these sites where the stones are perfectly fit together or carved out with these intricate patterns like putty, there's no way to explain how they did that other than they were heating the stone, some of these diorite, granite, they would heat this stone somehow to a molten state. Then you can slice it in half, stick it together, drill holes through it, no problem. And then it hardens back into a stone. But we have no answer to explain what tools or how they were able to make granite into a molten state.
Well, it's interesting you would mention that because there are those who suggest the tolerances in the pyramids in Egypt are absolutely impossible. They could not have achieved that then unless they were actually melting stone and pouring it, which explains how they could have done it, because those rocks are way too big and too heavy for anybody to have moved back then.
That's a good point. They're almost like large cement blocks that came out of a mill or something.
Mm-hmm.
And now Egypt is a really great example because you're familiar with this topic too. Now, the alignments that we see at Giza are part of this marker system. There's a crypt in Dendera, Egypt, where on one of the walls it looks like some of the Egyptians are holding up large light bulbs. I recently recreated a version of this bulb and actually made it function for the History Channel. But in that same area of Dendera, there is also a very large relief of an astronomical zodiac. And what a lot of people don't understand is that, again, these monuments are built as some type of large marker. Giza is an excellent example. Through the work of Robert Bouval, we learned about a decade ago that the three pyramids of Giza are a terrestrial map of Orion, right?
That's right.
Mm-hmm. We can use star charting and constellation software, Redshift, and various other programs so that you can say, where are the stars going to be above me tonight? Or where were the stars above me at 10,500 BC?
That's right.
Well, it turns out in 10,500 BC, Giza is perfectly aligned to Orion, the three stars of Orion, The Sphinx is looking directly into the constellation of Leo. So, I don't know how.
Can I for a second take you back to the light bulbs?
Yeah, okay, sure.
You believe that what's inscribed in stone, is that correct?
Yes, yes.
Is a creature of that time holding up what you represent is a light bulb.
Well, creature, I mean, you know, it's a human, yes.
I'm not sure what point of creation or evolution we're talking about, but okay. A human holding up a light bulb, and that would have been 10,000 plus years ago?
I'm sorry. Forgive me. So the artifacts in Egypt, just when we go to one of the crypts in Dendera, these are wall reliefs that were done by the Egyptians probably in, let's say, 3000 BC.
That's fine. That's fine.
But what it shows is two things I mentioned. The first one is why I was interested in Dendera in the first place. There are wall reliefs that show Egyptians holding what appear to be large light bulbs plugged into a device. Egyptologists say that that's a lotus flower, and the bulb, what looks like a bulb, is actually just the aroma coming out of the flower. I mean, it's not a very good explanation from the scientific community, but it
so what
does
did
appear
you do?
To be a light bulb.
You said you created a light bulb as a demonstration, yes?
I did.
Did you make a light bulb? I mean,
well, here's what I did. So I hired a person who is an expert in creating lighting, various like custom bulbs, right. And I had him create a filament-based bulb that's a plasma bulb. So just like we've heard of swamp gas, it's possible that gases coming out of just natural occurrence are ignited by a small heat source and they create phosphorescence.
Right.
So it's very possible that the Egyptians could access a swamp or some methane gas and give it a small source of energy, which is another thing I'll talk to you about, and create phosphorescence. So all I did was create a very light plasma bulb with 4 volts introduced to it creates a light, a phosphorescence glow.
Fascinating. Okay. Thank you.
Now, to top that off, the powering of that device, I created an ancient Baghdad battery, which I've also had tested for Discovery Channel and for History Channel.
Explain a Baghdad battery.
Yes. They found about a dozen of these in ancient in southern Iraq that date back to times of Sumer and such, 2500, 3000 BC. Mm-hmm. And essentially, it's a clay pot about 6 inches tall with a copper lining and an iron rod down the center. And we've scientifically known for sure that it creates an electrical charge when we introduce any weak acidic acid. Yeah.
And probably 4 volts would have been achievable, and so that's what you used.
Exactly. And I show those sometimes when I give a lecture. I connect the battery to the bulb and display that. So those are interesting pieces of artifacts and things that we can demonstrate. But, you know, as I was mentioning, the astronomical alignments and some of these things. So in Dendera, they also have a zodiacal relief that shows all of the constellations, you know, above Giza. But they show a view of the sky that's thousands of years earlier than 2500 BC. So it almost seems like the Egyptian culture at 2500 BC was well aware of this large cycle of time and referenced that thousands of years before they were there, they were in a much better state, closer to the Golden Age. And so they recorded this by showing the positions of the stars as to what they would have been, let's say, at 10,500 BC.
Gotcha.
Very interesting that they would make such references.
Right. I want to talk a little more about Planet X. So hold tight. We're going to take a break here. We actually have to do that about twice an hour. And we'll certainly dive right back into this. What do you think so far, folks? Could it be? I mean, after all, we are here. Are you willing to look at alternate possibilities with regard to how we arrived? I'm Art Bell. We're speaking with Jason Martell, and we're talking about the past. I mean the severe past. There's something I want to interject here, which is probably a non sequitur, but I can't help myself. We're talking about the pyramid. And Jason and I had the opportunity years ago to, this is when Zahi Hawass was in charge and before all the trouble in Egypt, way before, to go, and I was lucky. They knew who I was. When it was my chance to get to the Great Pyramid, I actually went to the top. I got to lie in the sarcophagus. And I don't want to go woo-woo on you here, but and it may have been just, I don't know, the climb to the top. It was humid. It was hot inside the pyramid. But lying in the sarcophagus, I definitely felt something that, you know, it's kind of hard to describe. I felt something. There have been many thoughts about what the Great Pyramid was or is. Any thoughts yourself on what that was intended to do?
Well, you know, there's lots of theories out there, Art. I couldn't stick to just one, but I do like to talk about the various theories. I've always resonated with Chris Dunn and his idea that it's a power plant, some kind. Huh. It seems that around the world there are monuments placed at geodetic points. They're somehow connected. Maybe at one point there was some type of world energy grid, and these monuments, Stonehenge, Giza, and various other sites tapped into this energy. Or, you know, it could be something more basic, utilizing elements. I heard an interesting theory around the water and the way the Nile and the tide recedes and such, that there are channels and ducts that come up under the Sphinx and under the pyramid, and just the pressure of this water filling these canals and pressing up against the pyramid actually creates energy and static charge that they were somehow maybe utilizing. It doesn't surprise me that if you were sitting in the king's chamber sarcophagus or the queen's chamber, that you might actually feel some type of resonance or an energy.
Well, I don't know if it was self-induced, psychological, or because of the unusual conditions, but I'll talk about it some other time, but I definitely felt something strong. Now, there are others who feel that the purpose of it and the alignment was to launch one's soul onto its journey, right?
Well, and, you know, we have these various shafts and things that, oh, yeah. There's a shaft in the king's chamber and in the queen's chamber that are very specific, that point to a star constellation, one of the bell stars of Orion, the star system Sirius. And I'm sure you noticed that when you were in the king's chamber and the queen's chamber, if this was a tomb, where are all the hieroglyphs, right?
All right.
It's like a big empty room. So
no, it is a puzzle. I admit that. So you take the technological road because it kind of fits what you're saying, and that's fine. And it could certainly well be. I don't know.
And there's probably some stuff in there that either they're covering up to a certain degree or we're just not getting full access to. You know, that little square, I think it's like a 1 foot by 1 foot shaft that they sent that little robot, the Upawat, up into and found that door.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, they did go behind that door, and they detected metal objects in some type of a hidden room, but kind of never made it out publicly.
Okay, so. And you also, as does Richard, you see a connection between the monuments on Mars and those on Earth, yes?
Well, when we look at the fact that there's pyramids and a Sphinx object, you know, in Giza, and then on Mars, there are pyramids, and from my own analysis using, you know, graphics and things to extrapolate data, that face has, there's just no way that the symmetry and eye and nose, headdress, winged formation over the head, like a headdress formation, there's too many pieces there to be a natural occurrence, and it does look kind of lion human-like, so... Yeah, I think Richard caught on to that, and I give him kudos. But I really don't think we can answer these questions.
I'm sorry, Jason. Somebody just sent a wormhole message to me referring to you, asking if Richard C. Hoagland and Zachariah Sitchin had a child.
Oh, God. I'm going to take that as a compliment, but, you know.
Well, you should. You should. You should. Somebody's got to carry on the research. It's funny. Sorry.
It's all good. you know, I mean, Richard definitely is on to something there, and I think we're really not going to be able to answer these questions until we have an actual frame of reference from the surface of Mars, so that just like here on Earth, these monuments we're seeing align to astronomical points, have mm-hmm. math built into them. So I'm sure that if we ever actually go to Mars, some of these pieces are really going to stack up. I did, your producer was nice enough to send the number 9 image from your site.
Oh, now take a good long look at that. What do you think, Jason? Is that weird or what? Look carefully. Do you see the perfectly circular pipe sticking out?
It's really, I mean, you know, I don't see how that couldn't be some type of a technology, a gear or a wheel.
Thank you. Thank you. I mean, I look at a lot of what Richard sends me and I go, sorry, Richard, rocks. But we got to this number 9, and I went, oh, my God.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Yeah, it's a good one. Is there any way that nature does that? No, I don't think so.
No, it doesn't. And, you know, you're also familiar with the work who should be more prominently noted. He's probably just out of the game. But Dr. Mark Carlotto, who was an image expert,
yes. mm-hmm.
and looked at a lot of the algorithms and things, you know, Cydonia... People don't realize that, you know, there's just, if you do some very basic science on these areas that NASA neglects, it really makes you wonder. Dr. Mark Carlotto is someone who, you know, is very familiar with running image analysis, and he would show various examples with Russian satellite telemetry. They would run mathematical algorithms on some Russian satellite image, and the math would tell you there's a 98% probability that that's actually a tank or some troops being, you know, covered by some shrub or a tarp. When we run those same algorithms on the surface of Mars, Cydonia, the face, the pyramids, they all come out to be way over 90% probability of artificiality. But NASA never did any of those types of tests, right? They just said, don't look here. It's a trick of light and shadow. When in fact it wasn't a trick of light and shadow, and Vince DiPietro and Greg Molinar found other frame grabs where the sun was in a different reference. So,
well, that's why I said to you earlier, isn't it possible that NASA is laying all this in front of us in plain sight, and when somebody finally says, I've had it, this is not formed by wind or erosion or whatever, this is not a natural object, when somebody finally says that and really says it loudly, NASA will say, well, you know, we've been releasing the pictures all along, we're not surprised.
I guess I would agree with you there. You know, I've seen in my career being interested in these topics, I started out very motivated 15, 19 years ago in college, and no one would hear it. No one would even consider the idea that any of this was logical. That is changing now because of all the things that we're learning that, you know, go into that pot and it gets stirred. So, yeah, I think there is a desensitizing of the public going on, and if anyone hear stories like Gary McKinnon and others that, you know, sometimes tiptoe into areas that they're not supposed to or hack a computer at NASA. You know, you do have to take these still with at least some realm of conjecture that it could be true. And, you know, NASA, again, is a public space agency, but from its inception, it's under the Department of Defense. You know, and anything they find that would be really cool, they're not going to release it.
NASA paid Brookings $50,000 in 1960 to look into the possible implications of discovering alien life in space and what it would mean to society, right?
Yeah.
And the basic conclusion of Brookings was what?
Well, they basically said that the fabric of society, the economic complex, the religious complex, would really be thrown for a loop, and it's better to quarantine this information until there's an established plan, you know, a way to essentially what we were just joking about, either desensitize the public or, you know, handle this with the proper quarantine procedures.
Mm-hmm. So you think we're still in the period of quarantine?
I do, and, you know, as I mentioned when we first started, I I usually, when I give a lecture or do a talk, you know, I cite evidence because there are artifacts, there are science that our understandings currently can put into a spectrum of truth with some of these ancient pieces, you know, artifacts and such. But when we get into the more of the current topics, it gets a little more slippery and, you know, difficult to not only put evidence behind it, but, you know, the Department of Defense and national security, I don't really have any interest in upsetting the powers that be, if you will. So there is a fine line, I think, to, you know, looking at some of these topics where I think it's best to probably just stick to the what we've learned in the past to help us see what, you know, could be possibly
All right. With regard to NASA, they have been making noise lately, Jason, about some big announcement that's coming up. I've heard dates for the announcement. I've heard them saying something amazing is going to be announced. And I'm wondering if you think that's going to be NASA saying, we have discovered microbiological life of some sort on Mars.
I think it's time. Yeah, I think it's probably time that they do step up. And I don't think they're going to actually be able to confirm micro, you know, organisms, but they might actually further pinpoint that microorganisms lived in the past or something.
Okay. All right. Something that people could digest without going, oh my God, everything I thought I knew was wrong. Right.
Yes.
So you expect such an announcement, I don't know, in the next 5 or 10 years or sooner?
I would sure hope so.
Okay. All right. Let's go back now to the pale gods that were depicted. It doesn't make sense. In South America, where people, of course, have darker skin because of the sun. In fact, that's true right across the world, in Africa or Southeast Asia or wherever you go, where there's lots of sun, you have darker skin on people. It's protection for them. Now, it is odd that they would not make these gods in their own image, but rather pale-skinned. It doesn't make sense unless, and I'll let you finish.
Well, unless there was, let's call it some extraterrestrial race that is probably very close to us, maybe even related to us in some way, or some lost civilization that we just don't understand that existed here on Earth, but they somehow were influencing all of the cultures around the world. So just like the idea of an Atlantis, if there was an Atlantean culture, they wouldn't have been technologically advanced on one continent. They would have been a global civilization. And that's what we see, Art, is that there's an evidence by these monuments and the architecture of these monuments around the world that pinpoints a lost race or a lost civilization. And here's an actual even further detail that I've just been recently kind of pondering, is when we look at some of these ancient sites, really ancient, even the ones that are just popping up. So Göbekli Tepe in Turkey, the Moai heads in Rapa Nui Island, the figurines in Bata Valley, Indonesia, and even the figurines depicted by the Sumerians, all have a similar style of a creature, a being, that is very slender, and their arms are always wrapped at the waist.
Mm-hmm.
So if we look at the Moai heads as an example on Rapa Nui, most people might not know that they're not just heads. We've actually dug out below the head, and there's a full body just underground of these long, slender beings. We see these same beings depicted at Göbekli Tepe. And again, they all have their hands folded at the waist. I think, Art, that what we're seeing is that these older civilizations are all referencing knowledge from this lost race, this lost culture that influenced all the greats that we know of now, but beyond them, we've lost.
Okay, Jason, wouldn't you think that if there was this great civilization that was on Earth at any time, that there would be more? Yes, we've got depictions on rocks and things like that. But wouldn't there be somehow preserved examples of some of the technology that you're talking about?
Well, you know, as our technology advances, we wonder, like, is a USB drive or a DVD Blu-ray disc going to be worth anything in 1,000 years? And, you know, when we look at some of the things that, like, crystal skulls or some of these rocks that we know a crystal can actually hold data. Now, we don't use it yet in our own, like in a computer, but I think, Art, that it's very possible in the future when our technology advances, we start to store data. I don't want to say literally in the cloud, but, you know, everything, even a rock, it's capturing the energy vibrations of anything that passes by it, and it sits right there for thousands of years. Why can't we just tap into that rock somehow and extract that data? Now, I know that sounds funny and far-fetched.
No,
but
not as funny and not as far-fetched as you would think. I think there probably is something to that. In fact, I think science is even working on the fact that information seems to get stored in particularly things subject to vibration like windows and things like that.
Yes.
So, no, it's not so far-fetched.
Well, so I think
in my opinion, as fast as technology is moving, I think that in 10 years, let's say, a Blu-ray disc will be off somewhere with beta machines.
Right. Yeah, it'll just be a basic Frisbee, and that's all it'll be good for.
That's right.
Now, Art, see, I do, again, as I referenced this lost cycle of time, I don't think everything is linear. I don't think it's going to be, we're in the future just going to become more and more advanced, and it'll continue that way. There seems to be a cycle here that repeats on Earth where we go into the Dark Ages and then into the Golden Age and then back into the Dark Ages and into the Golden Age. And I say that because we can look at the information being depicted by the ancients where they used this astronomical calendar based on the heavens. So the Sumerians, we think, because they're, you know, still the oldest on record, were one of the first to divide the heavens into 12 parts and assign it a constellation. So today, there seems to be a large cycle of time where we go through each one of these zodiacal symbols. It lasts about 2,000 years where, based on the alignments of where our Earth is to the sun and the star constellation behind that, the ancients had a very simple and ingenious way of knowing what age they were in. And just so that we understand the context of this, right now we're in the age of Pisces. Now, the age of Pisces is the symbol of a fish, which is also the symbol of Jesus. We're in the time of Jesus. That's going to end in about 150 years when we go into the age of Aquarius, all based on astronomical information. So it's very interesting that the ancients used this large clock to know, and here's how they did it. If you went out early in the morning, just as the sun is rising, whatever star constellation, Aquarius, Cancer, Leo, whatever constellation the sun is rising against, they would know, oh, we're in the age of Aquarius, we're in the age of Pisces. So they went to great lengths, Art, to know exactly where they were in this cycle, because all the ancient cultures, over 30 of them, explained how this cycle affects us. And I want to kind of put it into context so the audience understands. There's three cycles that we're aware of as far as the Earth's movement in the heavens. The first two we're very aware of. The third is where it gets a little tricky. First one is we're spinning on our axis. So
I'll tell you what, this is a good break point. Hold tight. We'll be right back. Jason Martell is my guest, and this really is fascinating stuff. Does it just happen again and again and again? And oh, yeah, X. Is it coming back? That definitely would change things. Jason Martell is my guest, and we're talking about things ancient, way before us. We'll get back to it in a moment. Attention, drivers. Knows a lot of drivers out there. You're listening to my show on, say, a smartphone or a tablet because you don't have the satellite receiver in your vehicle. You need the Senta Ally Bluetooth speaker, and I'll give you one good reason why. It sounds better. I mean, it sounds way better. If you listen on a smartphone or a tablet, well, you get a little tinny reproduction of whatever is being sent. That's all you get. When you add the Senta Ally, you now have a device that couples to your little phone or your tablet or whatever by Bluetooth, and then proceeds to play the audio full blast. In other words, kind of like a concert hall in the immediate vicinity anyway. It really is that good. You've got a whole bunch of music stored on your phone. You couple my Bluetooth to this thing. It's about 9 inches long. And, oh, my gosh, it sounds good. One was Bob Crane frequently does this. He sent one to a friend of mine for evaluation, Scotty. And Scotty loved it. Every single person who has seen the Senta Ally falls in love. And then all their friends want it. That's how it works. It sort of cascades. The minute a friend of yours sees this and hears it, they're going to go, I want one. Simple as that. Rechargeable batteries inside that play up for up to 10 hours. So in other words, it'll last about as long as your tablet battery. It's $69.95 and worth every penny. Call C. Crane right now. You can order one. It's called the Senta Ally Bluetooth speaker. 1-800-522-8863. 1-800-522-8863. You can call right now. Visit them online at C as in Charles Crane, ccrane.com. Also available at Amazon. Jason, welcome back.
Thank you, Art.
You were talking about Earth spinning on its axis. And, you know, for a second, let's go back and talk about Planet X. That is sure. A subject that really has a lot of people going. I get emails and communication all the time from people saying, Planet X is coming, it's coming, it's coming. You can see it on a clear day or a clear night. People are sure that it's just about here or will be here shortly. And I've always kind of gone, I don't know. It seems like the astronomers would be letting us know if Planet X was headed our way. But that doesn't mean it isn't. And that doesn't mean that a rogue planet couldn't be out there, because it could. So what's your best guess about Planet X?
Well, I think in this last hour, I'm going to try and hit it home for you, because I know a lot of people are interested in Nibiru, Planet X, especially what they hear online. And in this last hour, I'm going to kind of talk about the new model, which I think explains why there would be a Planet X, or it helps put into the context of a Planet X existence. But
excuse me, Jason, do you mean you're only going to be on for another hour? Because we have 2 hours of show to go.
Wow, that's great. Then
oh,
my
you didn't
bad.
Know that, huh?
I didn't know that.
can you stick around?
I think I can, yes.
Okay, all right. Planet X.
So basically, you know, the Planet X topic is one that's very interesting, because up till now, everyone has been assuming that it's just one sun, that, you know, our solar system is comprised of one sun, and Planet X is on this huge elliptical orbit based on the ancient information, and so it very rarely comes by our inner solar system. However, that might not actually be the complete model. Based on most of the latest science that we're getting from our telescopes in space, most solar systems, external solar systems, not ours, most solar systems are binary. They have at least two suns, some in an intricate dance up to six or more suns in this, you know, unbelievable orbit. But there's strong evidence to suggest we are a binary solar system, so that we actually have two suns. Our second sun would either be a brown dwarf at this point, or is something that we haven't been able to identify. Like, for instance, let's call it maybe Sirius could be our second sun, and, you know, it's somehow in this intricate dance with us, which is kind of where I'm going to lead into this spinning on the axis before we picked up after the break. So I realize the Planet X topic is very sensitive to a lot of listeners, and hopefully in the next couple hours, we can really start to boil down some of the science that I've been latching onto and finding very intriguing, which further change the variables of a Planet X model.
There are a number of people I've spoken to recently who believe there is another sun and that it is hidden and we can't see it because it's behind our current sun in some way.
Well, Art, there are over 30 cultures that were aware of this large cycle of time and specifically talk about two suns. Even the Sumerians have a very interesting tablet view of what appears to be like the Tower of Babel, and they're ascending it, and there's two suns at the top. But many cultures were aware of the idea of us having two suns, a lot of them coming out of the ancient Vedic texts in India and such. But where this
All right, really that issue aside for a second of the second sun, although we'll come back to it, but Planet X, would you regard Planet X as essentially a rogue planet that visits on a very long orbital time, like 25,000 years, something like that?
Right. Well, I think the orbital pattern that is talked about in some of these ancient Sumerian texts is they give it a 3,600-year orbit around our sun.
Oh.
We look at the Sumerian evidence and see that they had a very advanced math system based on two numbers, 6 and 10. So the Sumerians had mathematical constructs and diagrams that showed how they were able to divide into very small numbers and very large numbers. Some of these numbers ticked up into the billions. So one of the numbers that they used was 360. They were the first ones to designate 360 degrees to a circle. Now, if you just take a string and attach it to a stick, put the stick into the dirt and outstretch that string and then walk around, you create a circle. But they were the first ones to actually designate 360 degrees, and they called it a shar, which meant a complete circle. So they gave the reference of Nibiru, this Planet X, as having a shar of 3,600 years, which meant a complete orbit.
Mm-hmm. So let's see, 3,600 years. So it would come and visit every 3,600 years, presumably at roughly the same distance from the Earth?
Yes, and I did a little mathematical calculation a while ago, and around 2003, when this was, a little bit more hyped on people listening to things on the internet or looking at webcam photos that possibly show a lens flare interpreted as a second sun, I did some math that showed, if our solar system's been around our Earth, more importantly, for, let's say, 4.7 billion years, and Nibiru's orbit is 3,600 years, where every 3,600 years it's potentially coming by Earth or the inner part of the solar system. If we divide 4.7 billion years by 3,600, we get well over a million times Nibiru has completed an orbit through the inner part of the solar system. So it's probably likely that not every time there's an orbit, that it affects us. We could be on the complete other side of the sun when Nibiru comes into the inner part of the solar system. It might have minimal effects on us.
Well, it would change something. I mean, it would be close to something in the solar system, and so there'd be some great change every time, I would think.
And
perhaps not in Earth, but some great change.
Right. And, I know that people can point to things, the planets heating up in various spots, Jupiter spot and various things. Can't explain, what Nibiru's impact would be on us, but looking at the evidence, if we look at the spacing between the planets, just between Mars and Jupiter is where the asteroid belt is.
Right.
Now, right between Mars and Jupiter, there's plenty of room for a large planetoid object to be passing through. And there's actually even gaps in the asteroid belt that could be considered planet-sized gaps as if something had passed through it.
Mm-hmm.
And Art, I always jokingly made the reference that we're talking about the 12th planet from the Sumerians' perspective. They called it the 12th planet, as well as Nibiru or Planet X. But if we just think of it as the 12th planet passing between Mars and Jupiter, I used to make the joke that it's like MJ-12, Mars, Jupiter, 12th planet. But it's probably nothing. But, Nibiru has been coming through our solar system for millions of, at least over a million times. And, you know, I know the current hype today is that people are interested when they hear the historical evidence of how this interaction in the past caused a great flood and how the ancients are tracking this planet. But I agree with you in that I remember Hale Bopp very clearly. Mm-hmm. And I actually, as I mentioned, lived in San Diego, and my parents lived in Rancho Santa Fe, and something happened a few blocks over from my house.
Yes.
but, you know, the amateur community of astronomers has been very astute at always pointing out things like Shoemaker-Levy 9 or Hale Bopp well before the professional community, and then it gets escalated to the actual science level. So if there is a Planet X, we're talking something 4 to 8 times the size of Earth, going on the Sumerian descriptions. This is a large object. Anything anywhere near the inner part of the solar system, there's a pretty good likelihood that the amateur astronomers would pick that up well on its way here.
And if it made a fairly close pass, the impact on Earth?
Well, you know, in the past, as I mentioned, the Sumerians give a very elongated tale that explain how, in the past, when Nibiru passed by, it actually caused gravitational pull on our ice sheets, our tectonic ice sheets up at the top, and just like a ice cube being dropped into a glass of water, one of our ice sheets at the top of the Earth just kind of cracked off into the ocean and instantly raised the water 300 feet or more. So, you know, that's kind of a little disconcerting to think about, you know, that it has had this effect in the past. But Art, really where I focused my attention with the whole idea of Planet X and Nibiru isn't on the, you know, the catastrophe potential. It's more on the potential of reuniting with ancestors that are off-planet. I mean, if Nibiru does exist, it's very possible that we actually have ancestors that live on that planet.
That's well, yes, it's pretty heavy. I don't know that we'd be happy to see them again.
Or would they be happy to see us and what we've become?
Jason, if you do the math, and I know that you're doing the math, when might we expect, let's assume it's absolutely true for a moment, Planet X, when would we expect a close pass again?
Well, you know, Zachariah Sitchin had a specific date that's, you know, a few hundred years from now. It's really something that's going to be difficult to pinpoint until our telescopes and science can actually confirm where this planet is. Now, since the early 80s, Zachariah Sitchin met with the lead astronomer for the Naval Observatory, Dr. Robert Harrington, and compared the Nibiru model with the Naval Observatory model, which concluded Dr. Robert Harrington had a model that showed by just including one extrasolar planet, it explains all the anomalies we see in our current solar system, why Uranus is tilted on its side, why Pluto and Neptune could be possibly dislodged moons of Saturn, various things that we see. At the time when he was doing his calculations, again in the 80s, Dr. Harrington said all of the planets are suffering from something called perturbations. All of the planets are being pulled in a certain direction within space, but there's nothing there. There should be a large planet, but there's nothing there.
Well, it's kind of like thinking of a pool table with all the balls on the table scattered around, and then taking the cue ball and slamming it into the middle and see what happens. And
yes.
only actually, it's worse than that because of the gravitational effects. You don't even have to hit anything; you just have to get close, right?
It's kind of whiz by it, right? And so, you know, there's been this model being calculated for quite a while now that shows, you know, there's probably something out there that's affected our orbit of the planets in the past. And now as we look into this extrasolar Planet X, is there another large body within our system? What do? We go ahead and demote Pluto to not being a planet. I don't agree with that. But, you know, it is an interesting thought that we are now using extremely advanced telescopes. We have one out there now called the Spitzer Telescope. Actually, I think it was originally called CERTIF, and they renamed it to Spitzer. So either one of those names would bring it up, CERTIF or Spitzer, if you Google it. this telescope is amazing. It's sitting out in space, and it's able to temperature regulate itself, where it sits at a temperature just below freezing. And other telescopes that we have out there, like Hubble and the IRAS, most of these other telescopes are not able to penetrate these large dust clouds. When we start to look really deep into space, there are certain areas where there's these, you know, dark, cloudy masses, and we can't see through them. However, these new telescopes, like the Spitzer, are completely infrared. So they're able to calibrate themselves to the temperature of this dust cloud and just penetrate right through it using infrared, essentially a heat signature. So we're starting to get detail and see all these new suns and different solar systems. And there is a large likelihood, Art, that we will actually identify a rogue planet that fits the Nibiru model within the next 10 years that's actually viewable and trackable within our solar system. At that point, then it becomes a little more interesting to go, well, you're saying that there's this planet 48 times the size of Earth, and we're tracking its orbit, and it's going to come into the inner part of the solar system or be near us in 200 years? Interesting. We should keep an eye on it.
Keep an eye on it. Jason, that would be an ELE event, probably. If it got close, an LE. It's definitely an LE. I mean, I don't know if it would be another great flood, or if a hunk of the planet would break off, or we'd assume a new orbit that ended up changing the temperature on Earth by about 100 degrees. Something awful like that is definitely possible.
It is a possibility, but, you know, there's really nothing that anyone can do at that level. If there's going to be an LE event, like deep impact, what am I going to do to worry about it, or even, you know, research something like that? If it's going to happen, it's going to happen. Where I find it interesting, Art, is the fact that, you know, there seems to be another angle to the catastrophe side of possibility.
All right, but stick with that for just a moment, and then we'll move on. Jason, if your research led to the fact that Nibiru actually was coming, Planet X was or is coming, and in a couple of hundred years will produce an LE-like event here, would it be your position that the people of the world should be told, or that the people of the world really should go on about their business, and telling them would only produce the ELE event probably ahead of time anyway, because everybody'd panic and go nuts?
Yeah, that's a hard one to answer. I think my personal opinion is I do think that the world has a right to know, and I do think that the powers that be financially, I don't mean the government, private equity, would take our race off planet. I know XPRIZE, Bronson, Bigelow, there are many people that are looking into, you know, taking us into space. So I think in a couple hundred years, we're probably going to advance very quickly in that realm. But really, who knows? And Art, this really will go back to the topic of this lost cycle of time, in that there seems to be, again, which we're going to get into, a reason why we go into the dark ages, forget everything, and then go into this golden age and have this enlightenment. But it's very possible that, you know, there's another factor outside of just the cycle, which is catastrophic events. In the last time we were in the golden age, I calculate that there was also a cataclysmic event, meaning we're super advanced technologically and spiritually, and here comes a huge asteroid or something that, you know, wipes us all out and really makes us lose touch with this lost information. That could happen again.
Well, Jason, maybe it's sort of a cosmic race. In other words, this planet comes by every however many years it is, and it's a race to see if we have become technologically advanced enough to do something about it and get humans elsewhere to continue the human race, as it were. And maybe we just haven't quite made, you know, won the race just yet.
But we're
advancing very quickly now. Very quickly now. So you never know. We might make it this time.
Well, you know, ever since, you know, some of these, like, presidents, like Reagan, you know, giving his speech in front of the UN, you know, about, you know, isn't there already an extraterrestrial presence? I think it's really interesting that, you know, within our lifetime, hopefully some of this knowledge will become more prevalent, and there does seem to be some type of desensitizing. And I almost think, Art, that, you know, it seems like Earth is the one on quarantine. If we look at, you know, the idea of like a galactic federation, Star Wars,
yes.
Star Trek, some conglomerate races
yes.
collaborating, you know, if they were to look at us and see us blowing each other up, expelling natural resources, why would they want to give us more technology when we're so unstable? It seems almost like we're being nudged to make these decisions for ourselves so that we can be welcomed to this galactic table, if you will.
Maybe that's it. When we finally win the race, then we're welcomed at the table. Hold tight, Jason. Jason Martell is my guest, and we're talking about things past. Very, very past. I'm Art Bell, and this, of course, is Dark Matter on Sirius XM exclusively. All right, Jason Martell is my guest, and here is an optimist sending me a message, Jason. John, who says, hey, Art. Or, I guess, hey, Jason, could the asteroid belt be what's left of Planet X? What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, we're essentially talking about a collision between one of the moons of Nibiru and our primitive Earth, and the intermingling of the waters from, you know, Nibiru and its moon, as well as with Earth. And that's probably where we initially had life being seeded on our planet. The evolutionary process on Nibiru could have been taking place a lot longer.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very possible that the asteroid belt might actually contain other fragments of life that show a connection between Nibiru and Earth.
Well, I think John was hoping that Planet X is no longer with us, that it is, that all that's left of it now is the asteroid belt.
Right. Well, there was a very excellent researcher, Dr. Thomas Van Flandern, a good friend of mine that unfortunately passed away a little while ago, and he wrote a book called The Exploded Planet Hypothesis.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, essentially when we look at all of the other planets in our system, even our moon, we see extensive fragmentation from meteorites and comets and various things. So it's very possible that there was, you know, some type of a large, you know, event in the past that caused a lot of these potholes and things that we see not only on our moon, but on some of the other planets.
Okay. You have mentioned here something about a discovery that was made, something 2,000 years old, some kind of mechanism found in 1901 by divers. What was that?
Yes, that's an excellent piece of technology that was found in, around 1901 off the coast of Antikythera, a small island near Greece there. And it's an interesting device because it's probably about 2,000 years old, and it's more complicated than a modern-day Swiss watch. It has somewhere between 35 and 70 different cogs and wheels all intricately connected, and the Antikythera mechanism was used for two purposes, at least that's what we theorize. One was for as an astronomical device, so that as a person navigating on a ship, they could use this device to tune it to a certain point to a certain star, as an example, and it would help them navigate the seas. The other purpose of it seemed to be as an astrological device, where it could tell you, like, if you were born on a certain day, that the planet Jupiter aligns with Mars, and you know, then they would be able to give you more information about the zodiacal specificity of your birth date. But a pretty interesting piece of technology that's, you know, over 2,000 years old.
Amazing.
And we really only accredit it to someone like maybe Archimedes, but we really don't know who invented it.
Jason, when scientists, archaeologists find something really old that they cannot explain, they have a way of sort of putting that stuff up on the shelf and just ignoring it because it doesn't fit into the paradigm that they've decided is the way things were.
Yep. We've seen that in many instances of, you know, one of the greatest examples I like through our history is references of the power of flight. We see on various continents depictions of what are mislabeled as bird or insect models that under closer scrutiny, you know, we found one in Egypt in the tomb of an Egyptian governor, and it's labeled as a bird model, but when you look at it, it has all the intrinsic characteristics of a plane and none of the intrinsic characteristics of a bird. Same thing in South America. We found these trinkets, these gold trinkets that look like, for all intents and purposes, little jets, and they have a 90-degree tail fin, and you know, they don't look like a bird. They're mislabeled as insect models, but I think they're actually demonstrations for power of flight.
You actually have something called a Sumerian rocket, don't you?
Well, I not myself, but yes, there's an actual term called a shem. And the Sumerian descriptions explain how the gods, the Anunnaki, had these large ships where they somehow, a small piece called the Shem, would detach and come down to Earth. That's how the gods descended to Earth, was on this Shem. And it looks just like a rocket capsule, just like what we would do today in a return capsule coming back to Earth, a little triangular-shaped tip. And it wasn't just the Sumerians. Now, if it was just them, it'd be like, well, that's coincidental. But various other cultures, even in India, the Buddha would be ascending or descending in something called a stupa, which, again, looks like this triangular-shaped kind of a pod. So, yeah, it's a really interesting paradox there, Art, that a lot of the mislabeled pieces of evidence have either been put on a shelf and called something inappropriate, where it's not, you know, it's an insect instead of a plane, or they're just not able to classify what it is.
Jason, if what you say is true, if these cycles come back again and again and again, wouldn't you think that we better get our space program going again quickly?
I do, but for various reasons. You know, I think the threat of us having to leave the planet because of some catastrophe is less likely. I think the idea that, as we were mentioning before the break, there's a galactic community. I think I'd be much more interested in being able to interact with beings that are not from Earth. Let me give you an example. You know, I love my pets, and they rely on me for everything. I feed them, I give them, you know, their house, and I give them love. Sure. And they must look at me in such awe. I'm this being that gives them everything, and I'm playing with laptops, and I Skype them, and they're like, how does he talk to me through this thing, right? But they don't
have
understand.
Have any of them yet constructed any tall, pale Jasons?
No, I need to look in the birdcage a little closer, but no, not that I'm aware of.
Okay.
But what's interesting, Art, is that this connection that I have with my animals, imagine how they must look at me in awe and reverence. They love me.
Oh, yes.
We as humans supposedly had some connection with something higher than us, where we identified that, wow, we understand our place. There are beings greater than us and expressed to us in ways greater than we can understand. And somehow we lost that. The ancients had it, and now we don't. And I long for that, Art. I think that that might be part of our desensitizing is, you know, there's good and bad. And I personally believe that we would like to reunite with these ancient gods. All these ancient cultures were told by their gods, we are coming back. And that's,
Jason,
that's the question.
Do you think that with regard to your pets, that was your something you said up there, your pets love you, as you mentioned. Do you think they love you enough that if you died and you were no longer feeding them, they wouldn't eat you?
They wouldn't eat me.
Yeah, well, in other words, they're the love that they felt for you would keep them from doing that.
I think so. I mean, I wouldn't eat them. I jokingly call my birds sometimes they smell like little chicken McNuggets, you know, I mean, but I never eat them, you know. I mean, I love them. And, you know, we see this in interesting relationships with animals here on Earth where a goat and a mountain lion are friends, or a bear and a dog.
That's
or,
true.
You know, people who have had, like, actual lions as pets, then release them into the wild, come back mm-hmm. 4 years later, and the lion runs out of the crowd and tackles the owner, remembering mm-hmm. the bond, you know.
Indeed.
Or even, yeah.
No, all of that is true. Nevertheless, I think that if they were starving, Jason, they'd chow down.
Well, you know, it's like, I love them that much, Art, that if I'm dead and they need to feast on me, then hey.
No problem, right?
You know,
okay.
I guess that's how it is.
Well, you know, all of this is really fascinating, and there are so many people that believe this, Jason, and they believe it to the degree that they think it's about to happen again, that the cycle is about to commence.
Well, let's get back on this topic of the cycle, because it's a mm-hmm. really close thing to me that it's very esoteric to convey, but I think is immensely important for your audience to grasp, especially
oh, yes.
people who are interested in the idea of a Nibiru and a Planet X.
Mm-hmm.
A couple of breaks ago, we started to talk about that there's three cycles of Earth, astronomical cycles. The first two we're aware of, and the third is a kicker. So the first one is we're spinning on our axis. This simple astronomical cycle of us spinning on our axis causes day and night. Now, we don't think about it, but when it gets dark, you lose consciousness and go to sleep because of an astronomical cycle, meaning that spin of day and night changing affects us. Cycle number two is we're going around the sun. And as we go around the sun, seasons change, winter, spring, summer, fall, animals migrate. You know, there's a lot of things that happen simply because of us going around the sun. Well, there's a third cycle. All the ancients say that there's also another larger cycle, and we track it currently by calling it the precession of the equinox.
Mm-hmm.
And this cycle lasts 24,000 years. Whew, lot larger.
Yeah.
But all the ancient cultures, like the Mayans, had these intricate calendars that were tracking this large cycle of time. And they very, very clearly said that just like the first two, this third cycle has an effect on humanity. And I think that cause or the effect is we actually go into the Dark Ages and forget everything and then go into the Golden Age and have this mm-hmm. closeness with God. Now, what is causing this third cycle is the new science that I've been really latched onto and studying the last few years. There's an organization, there's a business partner of mine, a gentleman named Walter Cruttenden, and he does a conference every year called CPAC. Now, Walter has all of the great people like Dr. Schock, John Anthony West, Robert Bouval, Carmen Bolter, various hard hitters that are looking at this the precession of the equinox model mm-hmm. and starting to understand that, you know, this is something that has been affecting us for a very long time. There's an interesting analogy, too, so that we can understand and put this into context. You know, 24,000 years is a really long time. There's an insect that lives here on Earth called the mayfly, and it only lives for 24 hours. So if it's born on a cloudy day, another mayfly might come up to it and go, you know, I've heard these rumors of, like, sunshine and wind, but I've never seen it.
It's a good point. It's a very good point.
So mm-hmm. it's very possible that we live such a short lifespan that we can't not consider the information being told to us that there is a larger context and that it has an effect on us.
That really is. It's a very good point. It's a really crushingly good point, Jason.
Well, here's where it gets really interesting, Art. The latest science is saying that we're a binary solar system, two suns, and there seems to be a correlation between our binary orbit, where when our suns are at their closest point to each other,
yes.
we're in the Golden Age. When the suns are at their farthest points from each other, we're in the Dark Ages. And as this cycle repeats, we continue to learn a bunch of information and become very advanced to a point where in the Golden Age, we can actually, as a whole, some of the Vedic Indian texts explain that these yogis and things that go back tens of thousands of years, they explain that in the Golden Age, we can actually comprehend God. So we're about 9,000 years away from being in the Golden Age, but we're just coming out of the Bronze Age. And this cycle, even Plato tracked it. He called it the Great Year. It's a very interesting way to start to look at our history and understanding that there might be a cyclical pattern to our evolution.
Where does God fit into this, Jason?
Well, you know, God is, that's a little bit higher level topic than, you know, I would have any data. But I think...
Oh, I know, but I just couldn't resist.
It's
I'm
cool.
sorry.
Yeah, that's fine.
You mentioned God, and we're talking about these giant cycles, and I'm just wondering where God would fit in. I don't necessarily expect an answer, but...
Well, I have an answer for you, but I think my answer is, again, relying on our current sciences available, as well as a little, you know, slice of faith. I think that the gods and things that are referenced in our current Bible and various texts, you know, most other cultures don't just speak of a god, they speak of gods, even the Hebrew Bible, gods. So I think what we're looking at is all these ancient cultures that we revere now, Egyptians, Mayans, Toltecs, Mesopotamia, they're all speaking of a time when they got to interact with what they considered to be godlike beings.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have any of that now, and so we only look at a level higher than what these beings probably were, to the actual one god. There is a wonderful Sumerian tale that explains the Anunnaki's view of God. And the Anunnaki themselves explain to the Sumerians, we believe in a one god, and we call it the father of all creation. And I kind of like that. It's a nice phrase.
I kind of like it, too. Well, we do have the Greys, maybe. What is your view, by the way, on that? Are we being currently visited, in your view?
Yes, I strongly believe that. And when we look at the historical evidence of Greys even being depicted with Sumerians, there's depictions of these beings that they called Ijiji that assisted the Anunnaki in medical experiments and flying their craft. And they pretty much look like a Grey alien. You know, if we were created in their image and after their likeness, these I'm talking about the Sumerians and the Anunnaki, if the Anunnaki did have some genetic intervention with us and made us in their image and after their likeness, it's very possible they could have taken another Zeta Reticulan or some other type of race and cloned them or done some type of genetic offshoot, because throughout time we have these references of the Watchers or something that is overseeing us.
Yeah. Yes. Mm-hmm. Fascinating. So you do believe they're here?
Well, you know, as I mentioned, Art, I feel more inclined to talk about this stuff with you than most hosts, but I don't ever really mention these other things on a lecture, but, you know, because I stick to the ancient stuff. But I've, you know, I'm very intimate as far as friendships with people like Dr. Lear, Steve Neal, Whitley Strieber, not so well, but well enough that we've been through things, and I have been aware of people who have these circumstances in their life, whether it be alien abduction or removing implants or studying this phenomenon firsthand. Without a doubt, there is something happening now, and there has been for a long time. But as I mentioned, it's a little bit more difficult to get into some of these current topics without, you know, there is a
Well, I guess it's reasonable to ask. I mean, do you think that they're monitoring their work?
Sure. And that's the angle I kind of take, is that I definitely think that if the Anunnaki, from that hypothesis, did create us, then why wouldn't they also have, let's call it, a worker race that's helping them with their grand medical experiment? Every time someone's abducted, it has to do with reproductive fluids or genetic information, you know, producing offspring and things that, you know, it's all kind of in alignment with if they are helping the Anunnaki, that's all they kind of do is kind of check up on us and relay information, because they don't really show any emotions like the ancient gods did.
Mm-hmm. All right, Jason, what I would like to do is this. I would like to tell my board op back in D.C. to go ahead and open up the phone lines right now.
Great.
We're not going to take calls just yet, but we are going to take calls, and I'll even take Skype calls for Jason Martell. This is all really, truly fascinating stuff, and I'd like an opportunity for you to be able to ask questions. So,
thank you.
We have a phone number. It's a cool one. 855-REAL-UFO or 855-732-5836. And we'll begin taking questions from the audience after the break. Anything else that you really feel is important to get in before we do that?
Well, you know, as we progress in the show, I definitely want to come back to this topic of a binary orbit and explain some of the current research being done by the Binary Research Institute to start to look for evidence that we are actually in a binary orbit.
And with two suns, right?
Correct. Binary means two suns.
Right. So should there not very soon now be some technological way to confirm that?
Yes. All of our space satellites, all of our advances in being able to do extrasolar detection, we're putting a lot of focus on the star system Sirius, which is actually Sirius A and B. It's two suns. But it's very likely that there are planets orbiting those suns, and many of these ancient cultures here on Earth, like the Dogons in Africa, no connection to technology, no telescopes, accurately cite that as where the gods are coming from.
Mm-hmm. There was something that I wanted to ask you about. After the continents moved, what evidence is there that all those thousands of years ago there was movement from continent to continent?
Well, as far as trade routes and such, we have two ways to answer that. First, we have ancient maps that some of these go back into the 1400s all the way up into the 1800s, where there's, again, no conveyance of craft like a glider or a hot air balloon, and we have accurate topography of the North and South Pole, which means the landmass is accurately defined underneath a mile-thick ice. No ground-penetrating radar, no flight craft, but somehow we have these ancient maps that show our land continents correctly underneath a mile-thick of ice. How did they get that information? And then there's the idea that, you know, these continents have, at some point, were connected, because we see animals and species that have been on one continent and moved to another, as well as trade routes and things that over the thousands of years, we didn't think there was any contact, transoceanic contact between these cultures, yet all the evidence is pointing to the fact that, yes, they were all somehow in a large global trade that we weren't aware of until now.
Okay, good enough. I'll hold it right where you are, Jason. Jason Martell is my guest. And when we come back, we are going to take calls. So if you want to be part of it, 855-REAL-UFO. Lots of Planet X talk out there right now. If you have a question, 855-732-5836. We are here. This is Dark Matter. The lines are open as of now, and the number is 855-REAL-UFO. That's 855-REAL-UFO. Converted to numbers, it's 855-732-5836. Now, one more thing. You're welcome to attempt to join us by Skype. And I don't have to accept you or anything. You can just make the call. I am Art Bell. Well, actually, art.bell51. So if you attempt to call me, it'll come through. art.bell51. For Jason Martell, we're talking about great cycles indeed, the possibility of a planet that comes back every now and then. We've dubbed Planet X, and what a disturbance that would cause. So, Jason, if you're ready, I sense that they are. Let's see what we get.
Okay.
You're on the air from California, Margie, with Jason.
Hey. Hi, Art. I'm the negative lady again. And,
that's okay.
Anyway, I'm finding your show so interesting tonight. I was wondering, I read like the Torah or the five books of Moses, and a lot of things in that talk of the Nephilim and that the Anakites are part of the Nephilim. And they ate, supposedly, as it says, and all the people they saw were of great size. and we look like grasshoppers to ourselves, and so we must have looked to them. But also, one of the things when they had sent scouts ahead when they were out in the desert, 12 tribes, the country that we traversed and scouted is one that devours its settlers. So, you know, even in the Torah, or I don't know if that's even mentioned in the Old Testament, I was lucky enough to speak with a savant who was able to tell me, and so point blank, that the record number of things that were repeated in the Bible, blood was 447 times, chosen was 123, and the word seed was 280. It's just interesting that there's so many little clues, and I'm wondering whether the Nephilim would be coming in on the Nibiru or the
All right,
Elenin.
That's certainly a fair question. We'll take that. Jason?
Well, I appreciate the call, and wow, I'm not sure if that's the Margie I know, but I do know someone named Margie in California closely, and that was a very interesting piece of information.
Is Marjorie, you know, normally negative?
No.
This one is.
Okay, well.
Anyway, go ahead.
You know, the Nephilim coming in on Nibiru, mm-hmm. So the word Nephilim, the fallen ones, again, we're starting to talk about more recent descriptions, which I think, here's how I would answer it. We see an overriding theme that comes out of the Sumerian Anunnaki, the number 12. Nibiru is the 12th planet, Anunnaki coming from the 12th planet in our solar system. Well, mm-hmm. if we think about there's the 12 Greek Olympians, the 12 tribes of Jesus, the 12 tribes of Israel, the 12 disciples of Jesus, 12 hours in a day, 12 months in a year, 12 inches in a foot. All of these references to 12 actually stem from Sumer, originally saying that their gods came from the 12th planet and created, again, based on astronomical movements, all of the things that we use today around time and measurement.
So her question was, are they going to be coming with the planet?
Well, you know, I don't know. All I can say is that all the references we have for the idea of, you know, 12 gods in this system, it's very possible that Nibiru, again, was kind of the core story of all of these references to 12 in our biblical tales of the 12 disciples of Jesus or the 12 tribes of Israel, 12 Greek Olympians. So, yes, there could be some correlation to the idea that the word Nephilim is referring to, again, these ancient gods, the Anunnaki.
All right. Mark in Pennsylvania. Hello.
Art?
Yes, sir.
Sidonian Roswells.
Thank you.
Jason?
Yes.
This is your old friend, Mark the Webmaster.
Yes. Hey, Mark, the face on Mars, the second face on Mars, the man who brought that to life.
That's correct. As well as, you might recall, the two dolphins, which get very little coverage, but
yes.
Just Google that, the two dolphins at Cydonia, you will find that just like there are two faces, there are two dolphins. These are not a case of pareidolia or any other made-up term that Michael Shermer of Skeptical Society might want to come up with. They are right. Real, and they're part of something that, again, still needs to be brought out further, like you said. Now, I wanted to bring up, you guys have gone a little bit into the DNA and the genetics earlier, but left a kind of light on that. I really wanted to direct people and ask them to research chromosome 2. Now, you know, what this is, as you know, all the other major primates all have 48 chromosomes, and the humans have 46. In other words, we went from 24 pairs to 23, and yet somehow lost a chromosome. You know, lost a chromosome. Gosh, how does that happen? Well, what's been discovered, fitting right on, as you know, I am a Sitchinite, and I take his work to heart and consider him to be a genius on the level of Einstein, and later on, hopefully, he'll be recognized as such. All of his work from the past leading up to now, from rogue planets that the Sumerians talked about before anybody had any sense of anything like that, now we know that there are billions of them flying or whizzing around this, each galaxy. So leading up from that oldest information to now, the chromosome 2 situation is the following. Somehow, even though there's never been another mammalian fusion of two chromosomes where it was based at the telomeres, somehow someone flipped over the third primate chromosome, fused it to the second primate chromosome, and that's why humans only have 23, not 24. And at the same time, a huge amount of DNA and genetic information seems to have appeared together at that same time. Scientists will say, oh, well, maybe when that fusion happened, some sort of the DNA from some bug got in there somehow. Okay, all of this fits specifically and precisely in with the work of Zechariah Sitchin and the creation of humans by jumpstarting evolution, taking that Homo erectus, something along those lines, and flipping over, fusing the genes together and inserting their own. There is still a little bit of an open question, well, what was that required for? We can't be absolutely
chromosome
sure,
two.
Chromosome two, and if everybody just dives into that further, I think all of our answers ultimately. I one time was riding on the subway through Bethesda, Maryland, and I happened to see a gaggle of about 20 of these guys working from the NIH and the genetics department, and I questioned them about this, and they went stone-faced when I confronted them with it. So, again, there's a lot of questions still out there, but I think all of Sitchin's work will ultimately be recognized as correct, you know, on the large, you know, the overall value of it. And chromosome 2, I think, is where we're all going to be able to find out exactly what went on when humans were created. And, again, this goes back to the lady earlier that was talking about the Torah and what have you. The Sumerian creation tablets are a much more detailed version of the book of Genesis, the first book of the Torah, the first scroll.
Correct.
You can see it, like you referenced before, MJ-12. I actually don't take that as a joke. I actually personally think that that was sort of a little bit of a tongue.
Who knows? You know, yeah.
When they set up the control group for the UFO phenomenon, I think they very well, definitely by then, you know, had that sort of access to some of the old information. That the 12th, you know, the 12 the Anunnaki passed between Mars and Jupiter every 3,600 mm-hmm. years. And again, for the people that were wondering how does that work, you know, when you have a 3,600 year orbit that takes it 10 times out further than Pluto, and before it comes back from below the ecliptic and then comes back from beneath and passes through the asteroid belt, clearing out those spaces like you mentioned, you know, when that planet is out there, it's not receiving really any energy from the sun. So it's likely that Nibiru is an internally heated planet. That the gold that they sought after to create the monoatomic golden sphere around their home planet was something that they could only achieve from another, you know, an Earth-like planet where they could go and mine for the gold, which is why it specifically said they came here. And that's why they then ultimately, after there was the mutiny, and Inhar Sag and her half-brothers Enlil and Enki, you know, dealing with this mutiny, decided to jumpstart evolution. And that's why they created the easily hypnotizable, gold-lusting after slave worker that we appear to have been, and ultimately both a worker slash worshiper, which is why we brought the burnt offerings of the Hebrew Bible. That's just bringing cooked food to the Anunnaki beings, which, by the way...
Caller, we're kind of short on time, so...
I'll leave it at the question of Jason. You know, I hope you'll look further in the chromosome, too, and if you can explore that further, I think that's got a lot of the answers that you might be searching for, and I hope you'll address that either tonight or in future shows.
Thanks for your enthusiasm, Mark.
Probably have to be future shows, I would imagine. That's something you've got to look into. Very interesting, though. Very, very interesting. Obviously, a lot of people put a lot of stock in this. Ohio brings Jeff. Hi, Jeff.
Hello.
Let's see. Did I? No, I didn't. Jeff, go ahead. Hello, Jeff.
Yes, sir. It's a pleasure talking to you.
All right, you're not really easy. You don't have a very good connection, so go ahead.
Well, I just got one question. You know, we're always exploring, you know, like the moon going up. And really, I don't know the answer to this. Maybe I know. Do we ever explore behind us?
I'm sorry, again, please?
Do we explore behind us, behind the Earth? You know, like we're standing on the moon, looking at the Earth, the space behind the Earth. Do we explore that?
Well, I think I understand what he's saying. The best answer I could probably give for the caller there is, you know, as an example, let's say the dark side of the moon. There are areas within our solar system that are not completely visible to us, even with our telescopes. And so if I understood the caller, hopefully, you know, as an answer, I would say places like the dark side of the moon actually contain a whole slew of theories that come out that there's actually a civilization currently on the moon, on the dark side, that when we landed there, we were told, hey, you know, you're not really, we don't really want you here. And even some of our astronauts is being quoted, why do you send us here in tricycles when the military is here in a Ferrari?
Actually, so, yes, I heard that very recently, that we were warned off the moon.
Yeah, so, I mean, who knows? And that's obviously a whole show in itself, exploring that topic, but I do find it fascinating.
So do I. David, you're on the air on Skype. Hello.
Well, yeah, thank you very much. It sounds really good. Roswell's to you, Area 51's. Good to hear your voice. I really believe that we are an expanding Earth, and I know that the fellow who came up with that proposition died, but his proposition was not only was the Earth expanding, but the whole universe is expanding. Mm-hmm. Our solar system is, and the time frame between cycles, between the visit of Nibiru, I believe is actually shortening. And I don't believe that we have 9,000 years. We're closer.
Why do you think it's shortening? Because of the expansion?
Well, you had that notion yourself with the quickening. We seem to see that we're advancing towards another ice age pretty quick. And we just got out of the last one. And that hadn't happened before, so I'm just suspecting.
Mm-hmm.
Please continue.
No, actually, I'd like to have your opinion on it.
Okay, so one quick clarification I would like to make is that Nibiru's coming back does not coincide with our ascension into the Golden Age, which will take place around 9,000 years from now. Nibiru returning is probably going to happen around, I think it's 2190 or something like that. It's not very far away as far as Sitchin's calculations. And forgive me if I'm wrong on that exact number, but it's actually not that far off, maybe, you know, a few hundred years. But, you know, what's going to happen when this planet passes by us next, that would be hard to speculate on.
Okay. Louisiana and John. Hi, John.
Hi. Hi, Art. Hello?
Hello. Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Recent listener, first-time caller, really enjoy your show.
Thank you.
And Jason, I really enjoy your show and the History Channel also.
Sweet, thank
but
you.
Anyway, my question is, you mentioned the global power grid that the pyramids could be part of, and the Mayan, Incan, Egyptian pyramids may have been part of. Now, has anyone ever drawn lines between all these locations to see if any kind of pattern emerges? And could there be other places that haven't been found yet? Let's say, for example, like could the Bermuda Triangle be kind of a focal point for that power grid?
Okay. Well, it's a great question. Answer it like this. The geodetic sites like Stonehenge and Giza is actually on the exact center point of our landmass. And so many of these other sites, again, are at specific geodetic locations where it is possible that there was some type of an energy or something that they were utilizing, a world energy grid, you know, to tap into this type of power.
He asked about lines, whether...
Right. The other thing to at least say there is that there is a term called ley lines, and it seems mm-hmm. that, yes, many of these megalithic sites do fall on these ley lines, these energy, you know, signatures that, again, we don't really understand how this functions or if there's enough energy now even to detect it, but the theory is that at some point in our past, these were all charged sites that somehow transferred energy between them.
Boy, it really sounds like a lot of what you're saying is falling in line with some of what Richard Hoagland talks about when he talks about when he talks about everything, actually. A lot of what you're saying fits.
3.14, I know.
Well, it does. Let's see. Texas brings John. Hi, John.
Hello, Art. Sirius is really cool. I just stopped the broadcast so I can listen to myself later. Speaking of chromosomes, my question is, are we still slaves? I mean, I guess the Anunnaki came here and enslaved us, or one of the brothers apparently enslaved
nothing
us.
Nothing but a bunch of gold diggers.
Right. And so I saw with a friend a UFO when I was young, and that wasn't a problem. And then when I got a little bit older, both of my sisters, on separate occasions, showed me UFOs. One out of my older sister's bedroom window at night behind the curtains. They were flying around the house, and I said, what are they here for? Or what are they doing? She said, well, they're here to protect us. The next one was my younger sister out of my bedroom window at night.
How does this relate to Jason's?
Well, okay, it has to do with slavery. Okay, speaking of chromosomes, because nothing happened to me, and how did my sisters know to point out these UFOs?
Well, I actually love the caller's comment and question, and I'd answer it this way. There's an excellent 12-hour miniseries by Steven Spielberg called Taken, and it shows the involvement, and even Art's obviously a playoff in there with driving around in his trailer with the genetic little girl, which I'm sure you're familiar with, but Taken is an excellent series that shows these lineages, you know, the lineage track through an abduction channel. And who knows? But, I mean, I think something like Taken is an excellent documentary that sheds light into that type of a question. Because,
to be fair, it wasn't a documentary. Okay. It was actually fiction, right?
You're right, right. I use the word documentary loosely because they used tangible references like you.
Oh, they did.
Okay. And a trilateral symbol on the clothing of some of the people and Wacken Hut security. The point is, you know, certain things in our media and you know, I think Taken, to answer your question, is an interesting topic into why I might be lying in bed and I would get abducted, but not my fiancé. Not that I get abducted, but my point is that sometimes it's very genetically selective. Even outside of our family unit, they might want the child rather than the mother. I don't know why, but it is a very interesting question.
Okay. Montana brings Bud. Hi, Bud.
Howdy. How you doing tonight?
Fine.
Well, I was just kind of wondering because, you know, I'm a big fan of Art, and I'm a big fan of Jason, and I'm a big fan of the program Ancient Aliens. And I'm big, you know, Jason talked a little earlier about how different solar systems and the universes actually get closer to each other, and that gives us an ability to fly from one to the other as aliens go. And I was wondering, because I'm into this, like I was in Alaska when Hale-Bopp went by, and it was beautiful up there. I mean, did you guys see this? Did you read Discover magazine this month with this new comet that's coming in that they discovered like about...
Ison, you mean? You're talking about Ison?
There's another comet coming in.
Are you referring to Ison?
And they said it left the Oort cloud. You know?
Sir, can you hear me? Hello. Can you hear me?
Hello.
Are you talking about Ison?
Yep.
Okay.
And it's going to be here next fall. Now, these comets have a gravitational effect on Earth is when they come by.
You're right. So, they also have a static charge that affects our planet's electromagnetics. It's a really great point, sir. These things, you know, have been cited many times where I'm not scared. I don't think anything's going to happen. But I do think it's interesting that now we're starting to pay attention. And
because they're the comet. Like the clock.
Yeah.
Did I lose you?
No, please continue. They're like
that device that they found in the sea out there that was so precise. And our universe and our solar system is just like that. I mean, it's a big clock that just works like that. You know?
Yeah.
I've always thought that. And you and when you're on your show, Ancient Aliens and everything, and you're explaining this, I love it. You know, and I just wanted to, you know, just your thoughts on these comets coming in. I don't think anything's going to happen either as far as this comet, because they've already got it projected, and they ain't even going to be here till next fall.
Actually, ISON will be the closest approach to the sun, I believe, in November. I think that's correct. At the end of November is what I've heard. Now, I know that comets have a pretty significant impact on the sun, and a lot of people believe that comets have a very significant relationship to our sun, and frequently when there's a comet around, you see an awful lot of activity on the sun, and I would like to point out that right now we have lots of activity on the sun. Any comments, Jason?
I think it's very interesting that comets in ancient times were always a precursor to some event or change. And, you know, there's also the idea that any large body moving through our solar system, whether it be a planet X or anything, those gravitational forces are at effect, so that there could be debris following any large object. So that, you know, if we were to start seeing a influxion of a lot of comets, maybe that's a precursor to something else, you know, headed this way.
Okay, hold it right there. Our number is 855-REAL-UFO. Our guest is Jason Martell, and we're talking about ancient astronauts. I'm Art Bell, and it's Dark Matter. Remember, we've got Skype available for you. So if you want to call us on Skype from anywhere, actually, we'll just open it for all. But I'd love to hear from you out of the country. If you're actually out of the country, be a blast to have you get through. Or within the country, I guess, too. The way to dial is art.bell51. That's my Skype name, art.bell51. Jason Martell is my guest, and back to the lines we go. Let's go here, California, and Mike. Hi.
Hello, Art Bell. It's been a long time since I've heard you. Last time I was listening to you, you were on FM. You could probably tell me how many years ago that was, but I just recently got a vehicle with satellite radio and rediscovered you and been listening tonight. And Jason, I've got a big question for you in regards to biblical prophecy.
Okay.
The accuracy of past biblical prophecy leading up to today and the way the world is today, and Revelation and its future biblical prophecy, seems to me like somebody would have had to have an ability to travel through time to be as accurate as the Bible is and has been. I'm a born-again Christian, and I definitely believe that God created everything, the heavens and the earth, and that he is outside of time.
And there you go, Jason.
He caused this Bible to be written for us, basic instruction before leaving Earth. And I just wondered what your take on the future biblical prophecy about Jesus' return and the way that the world is going today is. To me, it seems like it's very, very accurately predicted in the Bible.
Yeah.
And I'll let you answer that, and I'll listen on the air. Thank you.
I'm going to say something. I think that Jason's take on things is not in opposition to the Bible, but rather he thinks that the Bible documents along with what he believes to be the way things happen. Right, Jason?
Thank you, Art. Yes, I very much so, from the beginning of my interest, am trying to uphold the biblical veracity.
Mm-hmm.
Very much so. And that's where it started to get very interesting to me when I, you know, find out about these things like the Anunnaki and the Sumerians. So, you know, as far as the Bible being accurate and things coming in the future, I too, as a young Christian, found things very interesting when I started to get a foothold into the field of ufology and just kind of tangentially noticed that things happening in the Middle East are escalating and have been, and I don't really know what any of that means from the biblical angle, because, you know, we're in a state of exponentially, you know, speeding up, you're quickening, but I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing. So the biblical prophecy of the future is very hard to predict, but what I do is give analogies that hopefully shed light into, you know, reality. Let's just say all of a sudden over Wilshire Boulevard and in Beverly Hills, these clouds emerge and this bright light spewing out of the clouds, and all of a sudden, Jesus, a figure that looks like Jesus in white robes, is descending into the middle of the street. What would happen, right? People would freak out. And then our sciences would take over. We'd want to test the atmosphere around Jesus, the gas that he's ascending on. How's it holding him up? His cloth material, what is it made of, right? We would take that approach. We would want
Absolutely.
To use our sciences to go, I'm blinking twice, what's going on?
Right.
Nothing like that ever publicly happens or has in our lifetime. Now, all the ancients recorded these amazing events like that, so it's a very hard question to answer what's going to happen in the future. And the mention of time travel is the last piece I'd like to comment on. Philip Corso Jr., his book, and the understanding that we've been taking the Roswell craft back in time over and over and making it easier for us to reverse engineer. It's a whole other topic that we couldn't even cover tonight, but I'm a firm believer in the idea that we must be using some type of time travel. There's never been an alien invasion. There's never been a nuclear weapon detonated. And I don't think there will be if we had the ability to foresee these events and then change the parameters so that they don't come to light.
Okay, so you think time travel is a reality and in use constantly?
I unfortunately do, but I don't fully
that's
comprehend
all right.
it. Yeah.
On Skype, Jim, you're on the air.
Hi, Art.
Hi.
There's a little bit of delay, so my timing's a little bit off.
Well, just turn your radio off and not to worry.
You got it.
Yeah.
I have been noticing many discussions over the last 20 years about Sitchins and the Anunnaki, and one of the things that really intrigues me is the possibility. There's a quotation, the Anuna, the gods whom An conceived in the sky. And, you know, I've always conceived of a visiting civilization, you know, inhabiting a planet or a really huge, you know, orbiting object of some sort. And I wonder how much thought the gentlemen have put into that concept of visiting gods on a planetary object.
Quite a bit, apparently. Jason?
Right. Well, if I understood the question, you know, the idea that we've had gods visiting us and they're coming from, you know, a spaceship / planet. Nibiru has been in question for ever since the idea that there is a Nibiru, a planet that we potentially have ancient gods that live on. Is Nibiru a spaceship? Is it a planet? All the evidence points to the fact that it's an actual planet based on the descriptions by the Anunnaki given directly to a human being and written down. And Nibiru is a very mountainous planet. It has very high mountain peaks and very low oceans.
How do we know this?
Well, we don't. We only have the descriptions of what the Anunnaki told a Sumerian scribe with a priest present, and they wrote it down as sacred information.
Okay.
So Nibiru is a mountainous planet, low water levels, and has a certain type of a glow to it. And the Anunnaki themselves are said to have had a glow. That's why we see a halo around these angels and beings from the heavens, is because they literally glowed to a certain degree. It's kind of like you are what you eat, and coming from a glowing planet, they maintain that phosphorescence naturally.
All right, let's go to North Carolina. And Benjamin, you're on the air with Jason Martell.
Hi, I just have a question about the Egyptian pyramids. I've heard you talk about the pyramids on a couple of different shows and then also today. Is it possible that the Egyptians had such a large, strong army that this army built those pyramids for their pharaoh? Or
that certainly would be the story. If you ask an Egyptian antiquities person, they would absolutely tell you that yes, that is how it occurred. You know, a lot of slave labor, the army, yes, like that. But if you talk to engineers and you talk to scientists, they will talk about the impossibility of And frankly, in modern times, they've tried to duplicate the pyramids with no luck at all.
They'd have to move like a stone every 2 minutes or something, 24 hours a day, not even counting the 7,000 tons of several, you know, trilithoton blocks that are put into place.
All right.
Does that help you?
I've been kind of curious to know how the Egyptian pyramids were put there also.
Yeah, so are we. Thank you very much. Your best guess, Jason, about how the pyramids got there?
My best guess is that there was a lost culture here that could have been human or a hybrid. It's a reference to those beings I mentioned earlier that we see at Bata Valley in Indonesia, or the Moai heads in Rapa Nui, or the beings depicted at Göbekli Tepe.
Right.
Slender beings with the arms folded at the waist. It seems to be that there is a lost race or civilization that they were the ones that were doing all the vitrification of stone and building all these monuments accurately and perfectly. And then all the cultures that we now know of have retained that information as best they could.
All right, to Canada, way up north, and Doug. Hi, Doug. Hello, Doug.
Hey, how you doing tonight?
Okay.
Hey, Art. Hey, James. How you doing? The question I had was, how come mostly, I'm not sure, but Caucasians all have two chromosomes less than the Aboriginals over in Australia?
Boy, I'd unfortunately have to bow out on that question and would just be giving you, you know, information that I couldn't exactly relate to that exact question. So,
okay, because that was my question. I just want to know, because I was reading on the internet that the Aboriginals have two more chromosomes than the Caucasians.
Gee, I wasn't aware of that. That's worth pursuing in terms of just knowledge. I'd like to know myself.
Yeah. Thank you, and I know a caller earlier, my friend Mark, who, you know, brought up chromosome 2. I don't know if that ties into that at all, but, you know, again, our genetics, I think, the deeper we look in there, the further out we might realize we actually come from.
You mentioned something earlier I've been curious about for a very long time, Jason, and that is so-called junk DNA.
Right.
I doubt that it's junk. I mean, whether it was God that laid it all out, or an alien, or whoever.
We could be offending somebody by calling it junk.
Right? Yeah, referring to it as junk DNA, probably, I guess I don't buy that. It means something.
Yeah, it's kind of like your tonsils. It does something. We just don't know what it is.
All right, to North Carolina again, and Les, hi.
Hey, Art. Many Roswells to you. Jason, according to your best math available, where would planet X be coming from? And I'll take my answer off the air. Thank you guys.
That's a really, really, really good question. If you were going to look in a direction, Jason, and you were directing a telescope to keep an eye out, where would you tell them to look?
The southern skies. That's actually a great question, because it ties into what you know, I kind of wanted to touch on earlier, but hopefully for a future show we'll dive really deep into the whole idea of a planet X and its current orbit, because, you know, everyone up to this point is plotting planet X on an orbit that's just around our one sun. So if we think about the fact that we're binary, planet X is probably, if it does exist, it's orbiting two suns. That's why it can go way out there and loop back around. There might be another gravitational field because of our second sun that causes it to swing back this way.
Okay, just a basic question, Jason. Why can't we see the second sun?
We can't see the second sun because we don't know where it is.
Well, but a sun, by its nature, even if it's a, you know, red dwarf or not particularly bright, is bright compared to other objects, right?
It is, Art. It is. But when we flip on the telescope, there's like 2,000 suns and rogue planets floating around, and we don't know all of their trajectories. We choose and pick ones that are interesting to the scientific community and track it. But there's very large possibilities that we've already taken astronomical plates of the southern sky, and planet X is in there, but we just don't know which one it is.
Okay. All right. Let's go to California and Danny. Hi, Danny.
Hi, Art. How are you?
Fine.
I just wanted to talk about maybe some of the other artifacts found that might support some of the strange buildings in Egypt, and you know, just talk about a little bit more of some of the things that were found.
Okay.
Well, I'd like to make a comment then about Egypt, which is very interesting for our view of the past. There is a series anyone can rent or check out called The Pyramid Code, and it was produced by an awesome lady named Dr. Carmen Bolter. And what this shows in The Pyramid Code is the fact that the Egyptian culture, the earliest Egyptian cultures, existed in a matriarchal state where we're now in a patriarchal state. What this means is there was a time in the earliest Egyptian dynasties where they were in complete harmony with nature. There was a balance between male and female, and it wasn't this male-dominated society that we have today. And so a lot of the a lot of the hieroglyphics and various scenes depicting ancient Egypt in the early dynasties are not viewed correctly through our current patriarchal male-dominated state. If we could understand the context of ancient Egypt where there was more of a balance, there are things that we just don't understand. And let me give you one little example. We think we have five senses. The Egyptians, the early Egyptians, believed in 360 senses. And somehow the pineal gland and various other glands within us are like muscles. And over thousands or maybe just hundreds of years, we've not exercised those muscles, and they've shrunk down to five senses. But it appears the ancient Egyptians could literally stand in front of you and just size you up and know things about you far beyond what we understand today.
Okay. To Canada and Dave. Hi, Dave.
My name is Roswell Zard.
Hi.
Hi. I was sort of wondering, Jason sort of mentioned, I guess he sort of already answered the question in a way, but, you know, like you see these representations of, like, space shuttle-looking things and airplanes, and then you have the astronauts, you know, with the helmets almost looking.
That, rockets, light bulbs, lots of stuff, yeah.
Yeah. So, I don't want to start another show. Well, actually, that'd be great, but... do you suppose that the military maybe has like, say, back in the 60s or something, has some sort of time travel technology where the space men that we know today could possibly be what they saw back then? Hmm. Like that they might have traveled to the past?
What a fascinating question.
That's a good one.
What a truly fascinating question. Thank you. Yes, they did draw these things. These things that we have today. So could that be a function of time travel? Something they observed from perhaps our relatively recent future?
Yeah. I mean,
in other words, by the time we create time travel, some of these things would be seen back then because we caused it to occur. Jason?
Well, a lot of the theories, too, around some of the descriptions of, you know, the grays as an example, it's some people hypothesize that on our evolutionary track of going into space, we'd use less of our limbs and more of our cerebral, and so we might actually evolve into a state of looking like a gray. And so that's why they're coming back and messing with us, is because that's us in the future, just thousands and thousands of years evolved into a space race. Not sure about that. But I do think it's an interesting idea to look at it from the idea that, yes, time travel, I do believe, is something that we have access to now. So why wouldn't we have also gone back into the past and flown around and done stuff? And, yeah, I mean, if that's the case, it makes sense that ancient man very accurately was depicting us using conveyances of flight with some type of time travel device slapped on the wing or something, you know?
Could be. Brandon in Canada.
Hello?
Brandon, hello.
Okay, I never heard you say my name.
I did.
I was listening about your talk on the Bible, and are you aware that the Bible talks about in revelations, the asteroids are... Yeah, the asteroids that are going to be the weight of a man coming down, the powers of the heavens being shaken numerous times in the New Testament, frightful sights in the heavens, another flood coming.
Well, that would be the return of X.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. The Bible is full of, throughout it, that I've read, references to everything that you're talking about tonight.
Right. Well, you know, the book of Revelations, Wormwood, Armageddon, there are various biblical terms that, yes, seem to tie into other cultures and even earlier versions of the tale. But as we get more clarity into the topic of Armageddon, I still, for me personally, don't fear or think that it's coming on its way, simply because of all the evidence that we're finding scientifically, like this larger cycle of time that lasts 24,000 years, and the ancients, like the Mayans and various other cultures, tracked it, we're only here for a speck of time. And I don't want to be too hubristic to think that within 100 years, it's all going to go down.
Okay. Illinois, Lauren, hello.
Hey, how's it going, Art?
Fine.
I was wondering if Jason thought Ison and Planet X had some sort of connection.
Ison and Planet X?
Yes, I think it's interesting that a lot of comets have a very similar elongated orbit, similar to what Planet X's orbit is, where it extends beyond our solar system and possibly passes through the Oort cloud, which is essentially another asteroid belt just billions of miles out there. So, you know, whether it's Planet X or a comet, you know, there could be, and there's science behind this, the term nemesis, someone can Google it, but there's research to show that the asteroid belt that's out there, the Oort cloud, could be maybe Planet X or comets somehow dislodge debris from there and periodically bring them towards us. And that's
possibly what could have killed the dinosaurs.
Yeah.
Does the fact that Ison is now becoming visible and becoming close and will make a close pass to our sun, does that mean that X may be close?
I think if we see an influx of more solar activity of objects and debris coming into the inner solar system, yes, I think that that should raise a concern. Because, you know, if there is a large planet, it's going to have a lot of debris and comets that get stuck into its gravitational pull in front of it and behind it. And so my gut tells me that if we were to start to see more things being reported, then that might raise an eye for concern, or it could be that our near-Earth asteroid program is actually kicked into high gear and they're actually doing something now.
But. Well, maybe, but we get an awful lot of reports, Jason, of that go about like this. Yesterday, astronomers tell us Earth had a very close encounter.
Right. I know.
And I hate that. I mean, yesterday, not good.
Not good.
So you think a lot of things like Ison. There was another comet, by the way, that blew up recently.
I guess
a few days ago. And so we are getting quite a bit of this sort of thing. And you actually think it could indicate Planet X is somewhere nearby.
Well, you know, again, I don't think Planet X is nearby from the simple point that our amateur astronomy community would be very astute at seeing something 4 to 8 times the size of Earth, let alone a comet. But I just think that if there was an influx of debris all of a sudden being noted hitting the sun and us,
then we should look harder.
That might raise an eye for concern. Yeah,
yeah, we should look harder. A lot in Canada. Canada and Greg, hi.
Yes, Roswell's to you both.
Art, thank you.
Jason.
Thank you.
I got a quick question. I'm curious about the pyramids, and could we not combine the technologies and find out if there's any? I was listening to their show the other day. EMPs, is it possible?
Electromagnetic pulse?
Yeah, the white noise, the recordings of the white noise in Egyptian pyramids.
Oh, huh. So you're saying, could we start to, like, detect resonance?
Has anybody tested that at all?
You know, not that I'm aware of. I'm pretty sure that someone has, but that would probably be more in the realm of, you know, like ghosts and paranormal indications like that. So while I find it fascinating, it's not something that I've pursued or would be able to tell you a line of research.
It would give information on how their language is and the accent and how it's spoken correctly, right? No?
You know, I mean, again, we're talking about trying to detect dead people talking in these ancient sites.
Yeah.
Then yes, I guess it's possible, and that would be a very interesting piece to throw into the mix. Unfortunately,
you know what would be really interesting, Jason?
Yeah.
It would be interesting for some of these people who do EVPs to go to some of the kind of sites that we're talking about right now.
Exactly. I think that's exactly what the caller is saying, and that is, you know, it's a cool idea. But I'd have to throw out there that for me personally, it falls into the line of evidence like channeling aliens or psychic abilities. Unless I have, with our current sciences, a way to test it, I can't do anything with it other than find it fascinating.
Okay. All right. Hold tight for a moment. We'll be right back. You're listening to Dark Matter. And this night, it's with Jason Martell from the High Desert, the Great American Southwest. I'm Art Bell. Jason Martell is my guest, and we are now going to, well, let's go to Georgia. Down to Georgia and Arnold. Hi, Arnold.
Hey, Giga Roswell's Art.
Thank you.
Okay. I want to ask Jason, the two civilizations that I never hear ever visited by aliens are Greece and Rome. It seems always the non-European, non-Caucasian civilizations that got visited by the aliens and needed their help, and not the Greeks and Romans, even though their architecture is massively more advanced than anything the Egyptians or the Aztecs had, and they had things like the arch, which are massively more advanced than the pyramids.
Great question. And, you know, actually, there is a lot of influence in the Greco-Roman era, but what we see it through is mainly through art. Even in the Renaissance age, we see various depictions of UFOs and flying shields and things that are put into the artwork. And really, when we talk about Greek and Roman mythologies, it's always around 12 gods, which is exactly what the Sumerians talked about, their 12 gods, the gods coming from this 12th planet, and a whole systematical breakdown of time and measurement of 12 hours in a day, 12 inches in a foot, 12 in a dozen, the 12 zodiacal houses of the zodiac, breakdown of the heavens. All of that comes from Sumer, and I think is spidered out to other cultures like the Greeks and Romans picking it up as well.
All right. Illinois and Dwayne. Hi, Dwayne.
Hello? Diane.
Diane, I'm sorry.
That's okay. I had a question. If we're truly binary, as Jason believes, is that what's causing the effect? And what effect does that have on the Earth? And is it possible that's the explanation for some of the catastrophic things we're having? And the warming of the planet and that kind of thing.
It's a good question, Diane, and I think all of them are connected to some degree, but how I'd answer it is, you know, this idea that there's this larger cycle of time based on a binary orbit is very interesting, because anyone can even study things like in the Vedic ancient texts, they called it the yugas. A good friend of mine, Walter Cruttenden, who runs this thing called the Binary Research Institute. It's another thing you can Google, the Binary Research Institute. But there's a good amount of data that shows there could be a very interesting connection between our binary orbit, and that when the suns are at their closest, we seem to be here on Earth. Maybe it's because of the energies of the sun, or it's something we don't understand. We're very highly evolved. When the suns are at their farthest point, we seem to be in the dark ages. There is a lot of good research to suggest that this is the cause of why we have a rise and fall of civilizations here on Earth, is because of this connection with our binary orbit.
Okay, I was just wondering if this is, you know, how they're saying global warming and all this, could that be explained? Because how the moon affects tides, could the sun also affect the Earth in other ways? You understand what I'm asking?
I think I understand what you're saying, and there's a lot of, you know, people out there that look at, like, spots on various planets and see, like, an upwelling of energy and think that there's a connection or various planets are heating up. I don't know what that could be other than maybe it's because our suns, possibly, are becoming, they're on their way being closer together, and there's this buildup of energy that's already starting to take place, and it's going to continue to expedite itself over the next few thousand years.
All right. Gene in Pennsylvania, you're on the air.
Hey, I was just wondering, what was your take on star seeds and, you know, their whole ploy to be sent here to help the humanity transition into the new age?
Okay, well, you know, I definitely am a believer that there is a hybridization project to some degree, maybe with more than one alien species. I say that with a somewhat degree of confidence in that if you took this to a court of law, the amount of evidence to stack up and that people who have been abducted, creditable people too, claim to around the world have encounters aboard a spaceship where the woman clearly knows that the being has brought her a child that came from her, but it's not completely human. Over and over, there seems to be some type of intervention with us and alien species to interbreed us. Who knows for why? I couldn't even tell you.
Okay. Ron in Colorado, you're on the air with Jason Martell.
Hi, Art. It's great to hear your voice again after all these years.
Thank you.
You're welcome. My question is, whatever happened to Hale Bopp? I know it came through. I watched it in the summer of 97, just as clear as a bell with the two wings, and it did bear a striking resemblance to the glyph of Nibiru that was in Sitchin's books, and I read them all. And I just wondered, whatever happened to that planet? Where did it go? I mean, we should have seen it
comet.
On its return. Yeah, the comet. We should have seen it return on its return.
I think it's got a longer return time than that, I believe,
right.
Jason.
I think, sir, again, I'm not accurate, but I would say that Hale Bopp's comet was similar to Nibiru in that it was very elongated and is probably not going to come around into the inner part of our solar system for a very long time. Let's say it's on a 3,600-year comparable orbit to Nibiru. You know, it might not be around for a long time, but I can't be extremely accurate to tell you exactly when that would be. But I know it has an elongated orbit, so it's probably going quite a distance out before it'll return.
All right. All right. Jesse in Utah. Hi there.
Hey, how's it going, Art?
Just fine.
I was just curious. You know, the Bible, a lot of stories in the Bible, they seem like fantasy. But when
turn your radio off, please.
Sorry about that. When you add in the fact of extraterrestrial beings, you know, the stories make a lot more sense. I was just curious if maybe chances they just left out, you know, aliens basically out of the Bible.
Well, sir, I think it's just a different slant on the term alien or angel all throughout the Bible. Ezekiel seeing wheels within wheels, Elijah being taken up to heaven in a whirlwind, you know, Moses on the mountain giving, you know, having this interaction with a burning bush and this, you know, this energy source up there. I think what it is just a different interpretation of what we would today call alien. Back then, they simply used the term God. But I think this is all a factual case of what took place in the past, but they didn't understand a spaceship or a space shuttle, so they gave references to things around them, like a burning bush or a chariot in the sky.
Okay, very quickly, Ron in Canada.
Hi, it's a privilege to talk to you, Art. And
thank you.
Years ago, my wife and I went to Chichen Itza, and before they closed the pyramid, and I climbed to the top of Chichen Itza and spent about, I don't know, 45 minutes up there just observing the landscape and getting the feel of what it was like up there. And you couldn't help but feel and wonder what really went on there. Like, they had an observatory there, and on the top of the pyramid, there's the little tomb or the small room that was up there that was really insignificant to anybody who really didn't know much about Chichen Itza and the pyramid there and stuff. So I'm just
wondering. Well, we'll have to hold it there, I'm afraid. Jason, we are absolutely out of time. I mean,
totally understand.
It's gone. I want to thank you for being here. Do you have any place you want to refer anybody to? I noticed you haven't written a book yet, so you haven't been...
I do have a book. It's called Knowledge Apocalypse. It's available on Amazon, Knowledge Apocalypse. My final note would just be that it was an honor to be on your show, and I hope to be back when I fill you in on expeditions we're doing in 2014. My God, I can't say that number.
It's a long show.
And we're going to be using commercial-grade drones to be getting some interesting B-roll.
Wow. Okay, I'll look forward to it, and I certainly appreciate your appearance on the program tonight. Take care, Art.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. That's Jason Martell. And that's it, everybody. Thank you very much for being here. We'll be back and do it again tomorrow. Don't forget the ghost photographs. We're judging them. And, of course, ghost stories. Email me. I'm Art Bell at artbell.com. Good night.